We're so thrilled to have Matthew Ritchie as one of our Mellon artists and thinkers. And I just wanted to give you a very brief one-sentence overview of what that program is. And this program was started under the guidance of Dean Carol Becker of the School of the Arts. And it brings leading creative practitioners and theorists to the School of the Arts to engage with students, the Columbia University community, and the public. With the generous support of the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, this program creates opportunities for undergraduates and graduate students to work with world-class artists and thinkers while stimulating dialogue about the contribution of the arts to the intellectual life and society at large. So, thank you so much for working so hard over the course of the year. And Matthew has been working with the students, and it's really exciting to have him here. And I'm going to pass it on to Emma Balaj, who's the Director of Academic Administration for the Visual Arts Program, and she's going to give a brief bio of Matthew.
Super brief.
Hi, everybody. Do you want the brief version, Matthew?
Yeah, definitely.
So, hi, I'm the Director of Visual Arts for the Tobijo Company. Matthew Ritchie is a mentor in our Visual Arts Program. Delighted to be able to work with him. And actually last summer, Matthew organized a trip to Las Vegas with a group of students, which was also another interesting program we're thinking about doing more in the future. But let me read the bio. So Matthew Ritchie's installations integrating paintings, wall drawings, light boxes, performance, sculpture, and projections are investigations of the idea of information, explored through science, architecture,
I need you to bring up
and dynamics of culture. Divined equally by their range and their lyrical visual language. Time magazine listed Ritchie as one of the 100 innovators for the new millennium for exploring the unthinkable or the not yet thought. His work has been shown in numerous exhibitions worldwide, including the Whitney Biennial, the Sydney Biennial, the Sao Paulo Biennial, the Venice Architecture Biennial, the Seville Biennial, and Havana Biennial. His most recent gallery exhibitions in New York and London, Line Shot, 2009, and Ghost Operator, 2008, and Monsters, 2012, incorporated architectural interventions, performance, and chance-based interactive digital projections to explore an alternate history of time. In 2009, he wrote and directed The Long Count, with music by Aaron and Bryce Dessner, a multimedia song cycle that premiered at the Brooklyn Academy of Music in 2009. Traveled to Holland Festival in Amsterdam in 2011 and Barbican Centre London in 2012. And in 2009, he also collaborated with the noted physicist Lisa Randall and composer Hector Parra.
It goes on for ages.
I'm just going to go. Do you want me to?
You can sit back.
Okay. That's enough.
Yeah, totally. More than enough, I'm sure.
Okay.
I'm familiar with that one. When you said the short one.
Okay,
yeah, the two
I'll stop there. So I'll hand it to you, Matthew.
So can I work this from here?
Yeah, you should be able to.
So I'm just going to briefly introduce this Graham Harman, who, as I mentioned, is the Dean of Speculative Realism and Object-Oriented Ontology. I'm incredibly delighted to welcome him and Bettina Funcke, who is a extraordinary art historian and author of Populus, among other many other texts. Between us, we're going to try and address what the Mellon series is all about, which is, you know, the production of knowledge, which is, as I mentioned, is not something art is supposed to do. As a sort of illustration of the problem of this, I was informed that academics, this is all the rage in academic circles. This is a presentation, which is essentially the exact opposite of the production of knowledge, is a sort of collapse of knowledge into. But it raises a question, which is, for me, which is like, with all the visual information that's being produced in the world today, the enormous quantities, you know, each year that goes by, we are entering an uncharted territory of informational excess. Last year, for the very first time, 12.5 billion devices were connected to the internet, a number that exceeded for the first time the amount of human beings. And we now exist inside a construct that previously we had always existed outside of. And this, I think, over time is going to exponentially change our relationship to nature. And the output of that is not both is not simply an abstract phenomenon. The storage and maintenance of the internet consumes the output of 30 nuclear power plants a day. And only 10% of the capacity is actually used. The rest is held back for surge moments. So in other words, 90% of the power that is just wasted, just so that you can log in and not have to have a 2-second delay on your device. We're building a world, and then at the same time, you know, we're all worried about climate change, you know, which has now, you know, been recorded as the worst in the 11,000 year history of humans. Last year was the hottest year in 11,000 years. So in two worlds, we're creating an anthropogenic change, both for our information environment and for our physical environment, and it's hard not to make the connection. And the methodology for that is something that we have to work on, and that's really a part of why the urgency of this kind of project. It's not simply an abstract, oh, what does art got to do with philosophy, although that is an urgent question for a teacher of art who constantly asks his students to look at philosophy. It's also an urgent question for all of us as human beings as we become more and more reliant on a constant access to an ever-changing matrix of what is it, knowledge, facts, information. Or is it really that what we need is this constant sense that we're burning through the information structure and the physical structure of the earth, and we've simply found another way to use it without acknowledging to ourselves that that's what we're doing? So it's in this context that the role of the artist as a supposed agent, as a supposed angel of ethical values, as a supposed actor on the stage, as a supposed producer of objects that are somehow special and separate from the normal traffic of human relationships, becomes, for me, especially interesting. This is what my Mellon project was set up to address, is in the time of everything. This is a time for everything. How do we address that state of being? So I'm delighted to welcome Graham Harman, who of all the philosophers working today is one of the very, very few willing to address that question in real terms that specifically identify our relation to things, hence the name speculative realism, but also willing to address our relationships to the things that we do not yet know or are not yet able to articulate. That's about it for me. What we're going to do is Graham will present, Bettina will respond, and then the three of us are going to talk about the issues, and we welcome questions and answers, and we also welcome you to come up here and use the graphic technology to show the audience what it is that you mean, to use this sensual object in Graham's terms to speak to these other real objects. Stop this now. I hope you got all that. There'll be a test later on the contents of the present.
Escape.
Graham, do you have a PowerPoint? There's no need to clap.
That was a nicely done presentation.
Do you have a PowerPoint?
No, I don't.
Do you want us to kill the screen?
Yeah.
Please do. It says neurology in big letters.
For a long time now, I've not used PowerPoint presentations because I like being out there seeing if I'm boring people. And I have no excuse. I can't have some good stuff. So I want to put myself under pressure to be less boring if that's what's happening. Some terms have been used already: speculative realism, object-oriented philosophy, object-oriented ontology. So I thought I'd first of all explain the difference and interconnection between those three terms. For those who don't know them, the oldest of those three terms is actually object-oriented philosophy, which I coined in the late 1990s while I was an obscure and impoverished graduate student in Chicago. And I did steal the metaphor from computer science, of course. I stole the metaphor from object-oriented programming, which I don't know in a special lot about. So what little I know about it, there are some parallels. But the motivation was not to take the concepts of object-oriented programming and map them into philosophy. There was a rather shaky article written by Alex Galloway in Critical Inquiry claiming that since object-oriented programming is used by evil corporations and ideological-oriented philosophy, I am therefore a servant of evil corporations. It's not very good logic. Anyway, all I did was steal the metaphor. There's no particular connection with object-oriented programming. Object-oriented ontology is the latest of the three terms, and that was introduced simply because other people started doing object-oriented philosophy with me but aren't really my disciples or anything. Levi Bryant, for example, does object-oriented philosophy, but he's got a very different set of principles from mine, and so he coined the term object-oriented ontology, or triple O, as this wider umbrella term that includes all the people doing object-oriented philosophy, such as Ian Bolos, Timothy Morton, and some others. You could even use the term for Latour, in a sense, though he's very different from us in some ways. And speculative realism is the umbrella term used for four very different projects in 2007 at Goldsmiths College, University of London. And if you want to see a not accurate account of how the four speculative realisms differ from each other, look at Slavoj Žižek's Less Than Nothing. Look at Speculative Realism Index. He doesn't do a very good job there. I love Žižek, but he gets it really wrong. The main difference, I think, between the two major wings of speculative realism, we're all realists, which in continental philosophy has not been popular for over 100 years. Continental philosophy always looked at the question of whether or not there's a real world outside the mind as being kind of a vulgar question. You know, it's a poorly posed problem, it's a pseudo problem. We're trying to say it's not a pseudo problem, it's an important problem for philosophy, whether or not there's a reality or whether or not reality is just the correlate of our thinking of it. Quentin Massieu and Ray Brassier are the two who think the important thing is that we should be able to know this reality. Massieu thinks that mathematics is a privileged relation to the real, that we can know a thing when we can mathematically formalize it. Whereas Ray Brassier looks to the natural sciences, which means that since scientific theory change occurs constantly, Brassier has a slightly more tragic relation to the real. We keep inventing these theories and they keep failing, and we have to keep stripping away our delusions, and we're getting closer and closer and closer to this scientific image of the real. Whereas the other two of us, myself and Ian Hamilton Grant, don't think knowing the real is what's important. We think the real is unknowable. We think that knowledge is just another part of the real. It doesn't have any special reflexive relation to the real. You'll never get knowledge. The difference between the two of us is that for Grant, the world is not cut up into objects. The world is this single dynamic becoming force that meets with obstructions and retardations, and that creates objects, this kind of temporary phenomena on the surface of things. Whereas for me, individual objects are what is primary in the widest sense. And I will develop that idea tonight. Can you hear me okay? Okay. I gave the provisional title of In Search of the Fourth Table to my remarks tonight, so I thought I would say what this means. At the Documenta Art Festival last summer in Kassel, Germany, there was a series of 100 notebooks compiled by Bettina here, which is how I first met her, and mine was called The Third Table. And tonight I want to push that a little further and go to the fourth table. I think that'll be the end of it. There will never be a fifth or a sixth. This is a reaction to a famous metaphor used by the physician Arthur Stanley Eddington. Physicist. He's the one whose eclipse observations helped confirm Einstein's general theory of relativity, helped make Einstein a household name overnight. But he also gave a series of lectures on philosophy, the Gifford Lectures in Scotland, where he said there are two tables. He's sitting at a table to write these lectures, but there are two tables. The first table is the table that seems to be solid, that the paper is on, that he's writing at, that can be used in everyday life. And then there's the second table that the scientists talk about. And that table is mostly made of empty space. It's got swarms of particles spinning around at very high speed. And so there are these two different things going on with the table. And there's no way to erase this duality. He ends up privileging the scientific table, of course. He's a physicist. My claim is that both of these, the first and the second table, are not the real table. The real table is the third table in between these two. I also hold that the arts have a special relation to this third table, and that philosophy does in its own way as well. And I think philosophy should be turning to this third table more and more. And I think as a result of this, and as a result of the fact that the arts are onto this problem, the third table midway between the two, that cannot be reduced in either direction, philosophy needs to end its four-century obsession with mathematics and science. You know, you've seen a lot of philosophers try to make their philosophies deductive, where you start with an unshakable first principle and then deduce the next truth and then the next and then the next, much like Euclid's geometry. Spinoza's the textbook case of this. This is becoming popular again, especially in French philosophy. I think that's a mistake. And I think it's also a mistake to take the natural sciences as our model, as much Anglo-American analytic philosophy does, and to look at aesthetics as first philosophy. There's a reason why aesthetics has a special meaning for philosophy in the coming decades and perhaps centuries. Parenthetical remark, Eddington's two tables have something to do with Bruno Latour's two faces of modernism. If you haven't read Bruno Latour's We Have Never Been Modern Yet, I strongly recommend it. This is probably the most important philosophical book written in the 1990s. Latour's only becoming more prominent and more famous over time, rather than less so. What Latour says is that modernism is an attempt to purify two distinct domains of reality, the natural and the human. And so on the one side you have nature, which works with mechanical clockwork precision and can be calculated with exactitude. And on the other hand you have the human realm, that's the arbitrary projection of values and cultural meanings, and the two have no relation to each other, and people are simply choosing to valorize one or the other. People are choosing either one or the other is special. So the natural sciences will say everything is grounded in this dead nature that could be calculated with ruthless mechanical precision, and the social sciences tend to say it's the opposite, that even science is a human construction and everything's grounded in that. Latour's claim is that there are very few things that are purely natural or social. Most things are hybrids. It's really hard to pin them down as being either natural or social. And in fact, he wants to invent a unifying term, which he calls actors. Actors are simply everything, whether natural, social, or a mixture of the two. Everything's an actor. Things cannot be cleanly divided into natural or social. I think he pays a certain price for this that I'll get to later, because he calls them actors because he thinks things are defined by what they do. He thinks anything can be considered real if it has an effect on something else. Whereas for me, a thing is real if it doesn't have an effect on something else, and if the effect is only derivative. I'll explain why that is. So this is sort of an upside-down Latour, but one that is very indebted to Bernard Latour. I think we need objects, not actors, and I hope that the connection with art is going to become clear as the night goes on. I'm going to start with philosophy, and in about a half hour, you'll start hearing more concretely about art. So let me first talk about my own approach to the history of philosophy. I see the history of philosophy as being a systematic assault on objects. I'm trying to bring them back. And not only philosophy, but much of Western knowledge from ancient Greek times has been an assault on objects, because most knowledge has been a form of reduction. And you can reduce objects in two directions. You can reduce them downwards or upwards. The first one I call undermining. You undermine an object when you seek to explain it by its pieces, by its causal history, by what something came from, its origins. This happens in both Western philosophy and science with the pre-Socratic philosophers before Socrates. Of course, they didn't call themselves that. Not knowing that Socrates would be born, they called themselves physicists. Where we get our word, obviously. They're theorists of nature. And they come in two brands, as Aristotle already noticed. The first kind is the kind that tries to find the ultimate physical element of which everything is made. Thales of Miletus is the first, and he says the first principle of everything is water. Everything alive seems to be moist, most of the world is covered by water, and so forth. These are some of the pieces of evidence he used to say that water is the first principle of everything that exists. You think you see tables and horses and trees and all these things, but actually water is really at the root of everything, and things can be reduced to water. Then you have Anaximenes, who said it was air. That everything is simply a certain condensation or rarefaction of air. If you compress air very, very tightly, you get bone or iron or blood. And if you rarefy air, you get fire. Fire, the lighter than air thing that rises. And then you get slightly more sophisticated versions of these theories. You get Empedocles, who says actually there can't just be one, there have to be four elements, air, earth, fire, and water, mixed by love and hate. That's what everything's made of. And then you get the atomists, who say everything's made of tiny particles, combining in different ways, swirling through the void. And this, of course, is the one that's closest to acceptable in our own time, atomism. That's one kind of pre-Socratic. They pick a physical element that is the ultimate tiniest thing that everything else is made of. The other one is the kind that believes that all of those things are still too specific, that what you have instead is what they call the apeiron, this sort of indeterminate lump that all specific elements emerge from and pass back into. The argument between these people is about, did this apeiron exist in the past, does it exist now, or will it exist in the future? Those who exist in the past tend to have creation myths of how did this apeiron break into individual things? How did this big lump-like, blob-like thing break into all the people and chairs and trees and horses that we see today? And you have one theory, Pythagoras, which is that this apeiron inhaled the void, and inhaled vacuum, and this split the world up into little individual sectors and things. Then you have Anaxagoras, who thinks there was this all-powerful mind who spun the apeiron around very rapidly. It started vibrating and it broke into pieces. That's another creation myth. Then you have Parmenides, who thinks this apeiron, which he calls being, exists now. We just don't realize it because our senses are deceiving us. But if we use reason, we will see that all of these individual things we see are illusions. There's being, which is one, eternal, unchangeable, and that's what's really there underneath everything. And then you have Anaximander, the first theorist of the apeiron, who says this will come in the future. Right now, we do have all these individual opposite things, but they're going to cancel each other out gradually over time, and in millions of years in the future, perhaps, you're going to have this lump again. It won't be different things anymore, which had a great influence ostensibly on Marx. Marx did write his PhD on these early Greek philosophers. So that's what I call undermining. What's the problem with it? The problem with it is you cannot explain a thing by boiling it down to its smallest parts. It doesn't explain emergence. It doesn't explain the fact that there are things that are not just the sum total of their parts. I can invent things that are the sum total of their parts. I can name 15 random people in the world and say they form a thing, but they really don't, except in my language. Then there are other things like New York that seem to have reality over and above their parts. You could try to say that New York's just a collection of individual peoples and building, people and buildings. But it doesn't really work, because you find, for example, that New York has retroactive effects on the people in it, right? You move to New York, you become a New Yorker. You pick up the accent, you pick up the habits, you pick up the lifestyle. So there is something there over and above the people. The people are affected by New York in turn. They aren't just assembled. New York's not just assembled out of the people. New York can create its own parts, right? It can create its own governmental agencies and build its own new streets and neighborhoods and so forth. And it also has qualities that if you take all the New Yorkers and all the buildings and scatter them across the world, it's not going to be the same thing that it was. So these are pieces of evidence that New York is actually an emergent reality over and above the elements of which it's composed. And reduction downward or undermining cannot explain this. There have to be objects at all different levels that are not completely decomposable into what they are. I mean, you can't disintegrate every object in New York and still have New York, of course. There's some dependence on the things, but you can, within certain limits, you can remove people, you can bring in new people, you can tear down neighborhoods, you can build new buildings, and the city retains a certain character. Where the exact dividing line is of that is unclear. If New York annexed the entire eastern seaboard, would it still be New York? Maybe not, but there are limits. But in some sense, it's not simply an aggregate of pieces. New York is a reality, and you can say this for armies, you can say this for circles of men holding hands, and machines, and international corporations, and airplanes. I would consider these things to be objects, even though traditional philosophy does not. So that's undermining, when you go downward, when you try to boil things down to their ultimate constituents. But there's another way of doing it. There's another way of destroying objects. And I've coined the term overmining to refer to that, overmining by analogy with undermining. English is lucky that it can do this. My French translator had a horrible time trying to turn this into French, because you can't, the words aren't formed that way. So he used some construction metaphors. But anyway, overmining is where you say objects aren't too shallow, like the ancient Greeks said. You know, it's not that objects are too shallow and all that really exists are the tiny things. Instead, the overminers are saying that objects are too deep. They're gullible fictions or fetishes. All that really exists is a surface of the world. Everything is language. Everything is power. Everything is what it perceives is perceived to be by us. Everything is an event. Everything is an effect on something else. Everything is a relation. Everything is mathematically formalizable. Everything is knowable. This is what I call overmining. There's nothing hiding beneath the given. And this has been very popular in philosophy and other fields for the last, certainly the last 30 or 40 years. This idea that to speak of a real world beneath the appearances is simply gullible old-fashioned metaphysics, and we don't need this anymore, we're modern now, we don't need to go back to that. And why does this fail? This fails because it cannot explain change. If something is nothing more than what it is right now, you cannot explain how it enters a new state. And I'll use my example of my favorite living philosopher, Bruno Latour, although I disagree with him on this point. Latour says in Pandora's Hope that an actor is nothing more than what it transforms, modifies, perturbs, or creates. So the thing is nothing more than its effects, in other words. There's no thing hiding behind the effects that it's currently having. Now the problem with this is, if I am nothing more than my current effect on all of you, and my current effect on the floor, and the oxygen in the room, and the world banking system, and all the other things I'm involved with at this moment, why will I have a different life 2 hours from now, tomorrow, a week from now, next year? How can I change my situation? How can I move from outside of this room if I am nothing more than my current relations to everything in the room? Obviously, no one is going to come right out and say that an object is nothing more than its current effects. It's not a question of what people say, it's a question of what is entailed by their philosophies. And I hold that Latour's philosophy entails that a thing cannot change, just as Whitehead's entails, that a thing is going to have problems changing. And so overmining doesn't work because you need a surplus, you need something not currently expressed in the world in order for new configurations of the world to be possible. The world is always a bit out of joint with the objects in other words. The world is never fully expressing everything that's in it. There's always untapped objects around us that are not being capitalized on, that are not being related to. So, let me just point out that I've already said that half of speculative realism counts as overmining for me. Massu and Brassier, who I especially found at Massu, think that the world is a possible approach towards an adequate scientific concept. Even though Brassier admits that we can never get a perfect scientific model of the world, we can gradually keep on approaching it more and more gradually. The problem with this, as I see it, is that if there were no difference between a thing and its possible knowability, why wouldn't my knowledge of a thing become that thing? It sounds like a naive question, but no one claims that a mathematical model of a tree is itself a tree. No one comes out and says that. But if you hold that a thing is nothing more than its formalizability, would follow that the perfect mathematical model of a tree should start bearing fruits that you can actually eat, that it, you know, should actually start growing in the ground. And obviously it can't. So there's a problem that these philosophies do not account for, which is what is the difference between a perfect knowledge of something and the actual thing itself? There's a gap there that cannot be crossed. As I see it, a thing is always, any knowledge of a thing is always a translation of the thing. You're never going to get a perfect knowledge of a thing. Even if you did, even if you summed up perfectly all 178 qualities of a thing, it would still not be that thing itself. So there's always going to be a gap that you can't cross from the knowledge of the thing. And so for me, the important thing about realism and philosophy is not that you can know the thing, because you can't. You can only translate the thing. For me, the important thing about realism is that there's a reality that cannot be known. It cannot be commensurate with any form of knowledge. So that realism precisely means the philosophy that doesn't believe you can know the real. I think that's the right way to go, not the way that Mayasu and Badiou and Zizek are trying to take it. Let me say something about critique. Critique usually means a form of undermining or overmining. Critique usually means you're trying to show that something's just a fetish, something's just an ideology, something's just a delusion, and you're the smart person who's going to tell people what's really there. It's really just economic interests, or it's really just power games, or it's really just atoms. That's what critique usually means. Critique is a name for both undermining and overmining. It's a kind of denunciation, as Latour put it. You're denouncing. You're saying that really what you're saying is just representing class interests, and I am the wise sociologist who knows what those interests are. It's a kind of critical denunciation. Now, that's the kind of critique that I hate, because I don't think anyone's in a position to do that. No one's in a position to exhaust anything else and pronounce perfect critical judgments on it. But there's another meaning of the word critique that I like. Think about wine criticism, or literary criticism, or music criticism. There you're doing exactly the opposite. Wine criticism doesn't mean you're denouncing the wine. This wine is just the product of certain family interests in Burgundy. No, that's not what wine criticism is. Wine criticism is you're trying to get at the wine through evocative poetic language, which can admittedly be very pretentious in the wrong hands. But when done well, it's quite beautiful. You have to talk about the wines in these lovely poetic terms. And here I'm talking against Daniel Dennett, one of the most reductive philosophers around, who makes fun of wine tasting in one of his essays called Real Patterns. And I'll never forget his phrase. It's, he takes a flamboyant and velvety Pinot, but lacking in stamina. And then he mocks this. And he says, what you should really do for wine tasting is pour your wine into the top of a machine that can then figure out the chemical formula for the taste. And then it spits out the chemical formula on the bottom. That's wine criticism. Now, obviously, you're losing something if you do that. And obviously, you're losing something if you simply do a number-crunching analysis of a Shakespeare play. That can be very interesting. My friend Michael Whitmore has done that in very interesting ways. There's something about the thing that cannot be decomposed downward or upward. And that's the kind of critique that I like, the kind of critique that realizes that you can't. You have to get at the thing elusively, indirectly, by somewhat evasive, elusive descriptions. The same with literary criticism. Good literary criticism takes on an aesthetic character of its own as well. It becomes almost like an artwork. All right, so that's the good sense of critique that I wanted to defend. Now, I wanted to say something else, which is that undermining and overmining usually do not appear alone. They're parasitical off of each other. They each rely on the other to provide it with backbone. And I've coined this term, which sounded really ugly at first, but I'm growing to like it. It's called dual mining. I didn't actually coin it. I stole it from the credit card industry. I found it on the web. Dual mining in the credit card industry means they're using data mining and text mining to figure out stuff about you. They're getting you from two directions. Dual mining in philosophy means you're undercutting and overcutting, or undermining and overmining reality simultaneously. You're just trying to destroy the object from both directions and say it's a fiction in both directions. I'll give you some examples of this. Scientific materialism is a great example of this, because it speaks out of both sides of its mouth. On the one hand, it says everything can be explained by being reduced to the tiniest elements of which everything is made, so we're going down. But then what are those ultimate elements at the end? What they are is they can be mathematically formalizable. They can be put in equations. We can know them adequately. And so that's the upper level. Again, you see, the world on the one hand is so deep, and on the other hand, it's so far at the surface that we can mathematize it. What's lost is the stuff in between that's real, but not equivalent either to the pieces of which it's made or the formulae by which it is known by humans. Another one, Latour's plasma. Okay, Latour again is, this is a disclaimer, Latour is my favorite living philosopher. This is just one of the areas where we disagree a lot. I think Latour starts to realize over the last 7 or 8 years that the theory of actors engaged in networks cannot explain change. And so he starts talking about this concept called the plasma. which is where all change comes from. He says the plasma is as large as London, where all networks and actors are just the size of the London Underground. So the plasma is this huge rumbling mass. Ultimately, I think it is the same thing as the pre-Socratic apeiron. I don't think it really moves the ball forward. And there are funny examples, sometimes tragic examples. He says, why is it that the Soviet Union collapses overnight without warning? It's the plasma. The plasma is where this change came from. The Soviet Union was this network, and suddenly the plasma erupts and shakes it up, and it dies. Why do friendships collapse without warning? The plasma. And then my favorite example, why does the most mediocre academic musician suddenly compose a brilliant symphony? I don't know if that ever happens, but it's a great example. It's the plasma. Plasma did it. And the problem with this plasma is it's the one and the same plasma for everything. Everything draws on this plasma to change. This one and the same plasma. And I'm going to argue that this is the real problem with modernism. I think this is more of a problem than Latour's diagnosis. I'll get to that shortly. So that's another example. By the way, I also think, since you're artists, that the sublime is one of the symptoms of this. I think that the real problem of modernism is this idea that the pre-human world is inarticulate, that it's humans that carve reality into joints, and that there's none of this articulation in the world before humans get their dirty hands on it. You can see this in Descartes' philosophy, where nature is really just one object. You know, that's why in Descartes there's this problem, how do the mind and the body interact? You need God to do it for Descartes, right? Because they're two different substances. To move your arm, you need God to move your arm for you. You never need a miracle in Descartes for two physical things to affect each other. Whereas in some of the earlier Arab philosophers, you did. In Islamic occasionalism, you did need God to make fire burn cotton. That's not in Descartes. The reason that's not in Descartes is because for Descartes, all physical things are basically one big thing. So you don't need God to come in and mess with physical things, which is handy for Descartes because it allows him to separate religion and science strictly. That's another example, another modern example of a philosopher who doesn't see the world before humans as being articulate. Kant is a great example, because for Kant, there's the thing in itself, which we can think about but never know. It's beyond the finite human categories in space and time by which we perceive the world. It's out there. He thinks it's causing what appears to us, but it's unknowable, it's ungraspable. But Kant also says we can't even know whether it's one or many, because unity and plurality are human categories. We can't really be sure whether there's one big lump or not. So again, Kant tends to think that the pre-human world is not articulate. And then we're going to get this in Heidegger also, I will argue. For Heidegger, being is almost not split up into individual zones. Being is unified. But more on Heidegger in a minute. Another example of this would be, I'm totally against this, the attempts to combine Whitehead and Deleuze. I'm totally opposed to this. Isabel Stengers, who's quite a considerable thinker, does this, but I think she's completely wrong. I think Whitehead and Deleuze are two totally different games. I'll start with Deleuze. Deleuze, like Bergson, is about becoming. Becoming is what's primary. You can't split the world into individual things, individual instants primarily. Things are becoming, their flow, their force. Whereas Whitehead's the opposite. Whitehead is about the exact individual articulation of everything in each instant. I am exactly equal to all of my relations to all things right now, for Whitehead and for Latour. And to get to the next moment is to get to something that's not quite me. It looks a little bit like the me of the last second, but it's close. It's not quite the same. It's a little different, and the same for the next instant, and the next instant, and the next instant. Whitehead and Latour, these are philosophers of individual situations that have to be strung together through a trajectory, that it takes work to string them through a trajectory. That's not the case with Bergson and Deleuze. So these are two totally opposite philosophical trends that are being forced into relationship with each other when I don't think they should be. And there are quite a lot of people trying to do this now. All right. Now, so I've tried to say that most Western philosophy, and indeed science, and social sciences as well, have been an attempt to overmine or undermine objects. Had there been any exceptions? Yes, there have been three exceptions. All the exceptions failed, however. And so I'm going to try to suggest that we need to try to do it again and not fail. We need to try to do it again and do justice to the object. The first tradition, of course, is Aristotle's philosophy of substance. Aristotle was the first philosopher in the West to say individual things are the primary things. It's not perfect ideas, it's not water, it's not atoms, it's not any of these things, it's individual things. And Leibniz you can consider as his greatest, Thomas Aquinas, there are others, but Leibniz is one of the great successors in Aristotle's substance tradition. Where does Aristotle fail? He tends to think of things as the natural things. He's talking about horses, flowers, trees. He's often accused of focusing on mid-sized physical objects. That's a pretty fair criticism, pretty fair. Leibniz, the problem with Leibniz, is even bigger problems, I love Leibniz, but he also does the same thing. For Leibniz, things have to be naturally things in order to be things. So a machine cannot be a thing. A machine does not have a monad for Leibniz. machine is simply an aggregate of different parts. He uses the example of a circle of men holding hands, which is a funny one. That's not a real thing for libraries. Two diamonds glued together, that's a wonderful example, as if one diamond was somehow natural. One diamond needs a lot of polishing to be what it is. So I don't see why two diamonds glued together is any worse. The Dutch East India Company is an example Leibniz uses in his letters. And I would consider the Dutch East India Company probably an object, because it meets the same criteria that New York meets. It has emergent qualities, not contained in the parts. It produces its own new parts. It has retroactive effects on the people working for it. Dutch East India Company seems to me like an object. So anyway, that tradition fails. There's the Whitehead Latour tradition, which is the newest one. They're very similar. The main difference is that Latour is more of a secular philosopher. I'll explain that some other time. You can read that in my book on Latour, Prince of Networks. Whitehead uses God and his philosophy in a way that is very much a throwback to four centuries or so ago. Latour does not do that. The problem I have with both of them is they're overminers of objects. They tend to reduce objects to their effects on other objects. There isn't a surplus. There isn't a thing hiding behind its effects or hiding behind its relationships. And then finally, there's phenomenology, which isn't usually considered a philosophy of objects, but I'm going to argue that it is. Do I need to speed up? Are we running out of time?
We're doing fine. We can go as late as we want.
Good. All right. So let me talk a little about Husserl and Heidegger. They're the two philosophers on which I based all of this object-oriented philosophy. And let's talk first about phenomenology, Heidegger's critique of it, and then go back to Husserl. Phenomenology was founded by Edmund Husserl in the Logical Investigations, 1900-1901. And one of the things Husserl was worried about is the growing power of the physical sciences in the late 19th century. It looked for a time to some people like philosophy would be replaced by the sciences, that you might bring in experimental psychology to replace philosophy, and just measure how the human brain reacts to the world, and that would explain all the philosophical problems. Husserl's way of opposing this was to say that these scientific theories, at the end of the day, are still just theories. We don't have direct access to the door slams, the scientific theory as it sends sound waves that come into my ear and vibrate my eardrum and send chemical signals up the nervous system and are processed in the brain. Okay, fine, it's probably a true theory, but we don't have direct access to any of those things. Those are very theoretical. We don't see the eardrum, certain scientists do under lab conditions, but you and I don't see the sound waves coming through the air and affecting the eardrum and affecting the nervous system. What happens is you and I hear the door slam. We hear the sound of a door slamming. That's what we hear. And Husserl invites us to undertake a very detailed and patient description of that experience. And we find aspects of it that we wouldn't have if we hadn't carefully described it. Husserl famously had his students describe a mailbox for a semester, trying to find things about it that we don't realize, like the fact that you only see the front side of the mailbox, but you assume the back side is there, and there's other things going on that you can get out of these descriptions. I'll come back to Husserl in a minute, but Heidegger can be viewed as a rebel disciple of Husserl, who made the claim that actually we don't primarily encounter things as appearances in the mind. Contra what Husserl is saying, things are not primarily phenomena, things are primarily not present to us unless they malfunction. You were not thinking of the chairs in this room until I mentioned them, but you're sitting in them, right? You're relying on them to be able to stay in a certain posture and not collapse to the floor. You're relying on the floor of this room not to have you fall five stories into the basement and be injured or killed. You're relying on your mastery of English grammar to not have to think too hard about the structure of what I'm saying linguistically. You're relying on your bodily organs to keep you alive. You're relying on a basically stable political situation in New York. You don't have to worry about armed militias entering the room, I hope. There are things that we're taking for granted, is Heidegger's point. There are certain social conditions that we've all been socialized in certain ways that we don't think about. All of these things are there as a background. That's what most of reality is like, according to Heidegger. The case of phenomena present in the mind is actually a pretty rare case. And it happens most often in cases of malfunction. This is what his tool analysis is about. His tool analysis, he's not just talking about screwdrivers and hammers. He's talking about all entities. All entities vanish into a background in most cases. And they come to presence in our mind only under certain very special conditions, such as malfunction, such as my specifically deciding to perceive them, turning my head and looking at them, such as my making theories about them. These are all what Heidegger calls presence at hand, Vorhandenheit, the things that are present at hand. There are several ways in which you can have presence at hand, but primarily it's presence for the mind. Presence in the mind, which is what phenomenology was about. Heidegger criticized this. The opposite concept he invents, Zuhandenheit, or readiness to hand, is what we associate with tools, things that vanish into a background. And there's this constant reversal for Heidegger between what's hidden and what's present, what's veiled, what's unveiled, what's withdrawn, what's present. These pairs of terms all mean the same thing for him. You have a reality that's hidden and then it erupts into view. Okay, he also tends to say that these tools form a system. He says that there's no such thing as a tool, because the tools all refer to each other. The chair has to be a specific weight so as not to collapse to the floor. You cannot have chairs made of granite or of iron. It's going to damage the floor, probably crash through it. The chair has to refer to the shape of the human body. These chairs would not work for Neanderthals or for, you know, Lovecraftian monstrosities. They're shaped for the human body. All the tools link together by referring to what the other tools refer to. This is Heidegger's view of the tools as a giant hidden system. So he's often misread, in my opinion. This is a complete misreading. Heidegger's misread is the person who showed us that all theory is grounded in practice, that you cannot make a theory of things or see things unless you have this unconscious practical background, tools being used. Now, what's the problem with this? And that's why, in fact, some philosophers, like Richard Rorty, says Heidegger's not saying anything that John Dewey, the pragmatist philosopher, hadn't seen 30 years earlier. All Heidegger's doing is adding a bunch of 30,000 pages of history of philosophy to it. No, Heidegger's not a pragmatist. The reason Heidegger is not a pragmatist is because using stuff distorts it just as much as looking at it does. It's not as if using a hammer or using this floor has some special intimate contact with it that looking at it doesn't. If I look at the floor, floor is a stupid example. If I look at a chemical, I make a theory about a chemical, I'm distorting the reality of that chemical. I'm formalizing it, I'm turning it into an abstraction that is somehow, in principle, different from the chemical itself. But the same is true if I use the chemical. If I use anything, I am also using only certain aspects of it. If I use a fire, I'm not exhausting the essence of the fire. If I look at a fire, I'm not exhausting the essence of the fire. All of the objects are deeper than any relation I can have to them, whether it's a theoretical relation, a perceptual relation, a practical relation. None of my relations to the things can exhaust them. There's a depth in the things that is not exhausted by theory or by practice. That's why the pragmatist reading of Heidegger is simply wrong. Now you have to push it another step further. I won't get too much into this tonight. This is the weird part of my philosophy that people don't accept as much. And that is that objects do this to each other too. It's not just that we poor tragic humans are finite and can't reach the thing in itself. That's, you know, Kant already told us that. It's also that objects cannot reach each other either. When the fire burns the cotton, to use the famous example from Islamic philosophy, the fire does not burn all the properties of the cotton. The fire destroys the cotton, but the fire does not interact with the color or the smell of the cotton, the softness of it probably. There are lots of qualities of the cotton that the fire has no access to that are completely irrelevant to the fire. The point being that any relation between any two things involves a distortion or a translation. No two things exhaust each other. It's not just poor humans and smart animals that can't grasp the world. It's everything. Nothing can grasp the world. Nothing exhausts the world. Things are separated from each other. Things do not exhaust each other's depths. And this raises a problem I'll mention in passing, which is that if things withdraw from each other, how can they affect each other at all? If the fire only touches certain properties of the cotton, then it's not really touching the cotton, right? It's touching some of the properties. It's not touching the cotton itself, which withdraws from it. And the cotton withdraws from the fire withdraws from the cotton. So how can things affect each other at all? Which might not sound like a real problem to you, but it is. Some people say this is a pseudo problem. It's no problem. The fire makes contact with 27% of the qualities of the cotton. And who cares if the other 73% of the qualities are in them? No, you can't do that because a thing is not bundled out of qualities. You cannot make contact with 27% of the cotton. Either you make contact with the cotton or you don't. It's an either or binary question. Because if you make contact only with the qualities of the cotton, then how do the qualities of the cotton make contact with the cotton? It's always going to be a problem if you don't have a direct contact somewhere. There has to be a direct contact. And this is the problem I call vicarious causation. All causation has to be indirect. No two real objects can touch each other. This is not unprecedented in the history of philosophy. This is called occasionalism. It started in Islamic theology and came into the West through 17th century French metaphysics, the Cartesians. It started in Islamic theology because there were certain very conservative theologians known as the Asharites in southern Iraq who thought that not only is it blasphemous to say that others can create besides gods, it's also blasphemous to say others can have a causal power besides God. They took it very strictly to say that nothing can affect anything else except God. So I shake your hand, it's actually God allowing us to shake hands. And again, the French Cartesians saw this, Descartes himself saw this only as a mind-body problem, that God had to bridge the gap between mind and body. Then some of Descartes' French followers brought back this Arab problem of body-body interactions. The body-body interactions are also a problem. And we laugh at this now, right? You can say, oh, that's very funny, God is coming in and picking up the bottle for me, that's so naive and retrograde. But not really. Because the problem with that theory is not that it's gods. The problem with that theory is that one entity is given a causal monopoly over the whole universe, gods. It's no better if you give another entity the causal monopoly. And what other entity was given that monopoly? The mind, the human mind. In Hume and Kant, who are still very much mainstream philosophers, in a way that these other occasionalists are not, what does Hume tell us causation is? He says it's a habit formed by the mind. Every time I put my hand in the fire, it hurts, and so I start assuming that there's, you know, the fire has the power to cause pain. What he's saying there is that the only access we have to causality is the human monopoly. Instead of God being the source of all causation, human habit is the source of all causation, because that's the only way we encounter it. Immanuel Kant, cause and effect is causation is a category of the human mind. So there too. And Hume and Kant are still fully acceptable mainstream philosophers. You can literally be a Humean or a Kantian and be a successful professor in a philosophy department. Whereas you can't literally believe God is causing everything every second and get a job in a philosophy department. But it's just
called humble.
Maybe where I'm teaching. But not even there, I don't think. So that's the problem of vicarious causation, but I'm not going to talk too much about that tonight. I just wanted to say this gets a bit weird. It's not just a theory about objects hiding from humans. It's a theory about objects hiding from each other as well, which is why I completely disagree with the strands of speculative realism that say that the way to respond to this in the arts is to say that the world is there as a trauma that shocks us. Well, yeah, it does, but reality does more than traumatize humans. Reality isn't there just there to surprise and shock us. Reality also has parts that interact with each other as well. All right, now back to Husserl. I've already said that Heidegger talks about objects being deeper than their visible qualities. Objects hide behind the qualities that we see of them. And we're surprised from time to time by the failure of objects. So Husserl so far has just been treated as this dupe who thinks everything is present in the mind and Heidegger came and overthrew him. Okay. Husserl's more interesting than that. Because what Husserl showed for the first time in the history of philosophy, in my opinion, is that even on the level of experience and perception, there's another kind of tension. There's a tension between objects and their qualities. What does this mean? Why is this important? Empiricism. You know, Hume and some of the other British philosophers of that period, Locke, did not really believe there were objects in experience. They believed there were qualities. There were bundles of qualities. So for them, I don't really experience an apple. I experience red, sweet, spherical, juicy, hard, round, cold. And since I see those qualities go together all the time, I start thinking there's this magical substrate that links them all together. But actually, all I see are the qualities. That's the empiricist view on things and experience. Husserl reverses this, and phenomenology in general reverses this and says we encounter the thing first. We encounter the thing as separate from its qualities. On what basis does he say this? Well, because Husserl notes that in experience, we encounter objects even though we are seeing objects only from one particular side. I'm seeing only the front side of all of you right now. It never occurs to me that you're, you know, two-dimensional cardboard things. I'm constantly assuming there's a backside to you, that there's internal organs, that you have a life when you're not in this audience. I don't know what it is, but you have, you know, biography and you have friends and a home to live in and all these things. I'm assuming these things. I don't see them directly. And if I encounter you tomorrow in a different place, like a different part of the city, or if I see you in Egypt a year from now by accident, I don't think, oh, this person is very similar to the person I saw at Columbia, but now they're in Egypt and they're wearing different clothes and I'm seeing them from the side instead of the front. So there's a close family resemblance there, but they're not quite the same person because they have different qualities. No, it's ridiculous. I say it's the same person. Right? They're just, I'm seeing a different side of them now, because I'm seeing them in Egypt instead of New York, I'm seeing them at home instead of the office, I'm seeing them in a blue shirt instead of a red one. What we encounter is the objects. The qualities are accidental, they're kind of encrusted on the thing. They change constantly. So there's another tension there. We have two tensions now. We have the tension where Heidegger's talking about the real objects that hide, and there are these surface qualities through which we know them. And then there's Husserl, who's talking about an object that doesn't hide at all. He's talking about an object within the senses. I call this a sensual object. It's not a real object. The thing that hides in Heidegger, I call the real object, because it's there whether we like it or not. It's there whether we're looking at it or not. It's there if we sleep or die. That's the real object. But it also has sensual qualities, because the hammer might be hiding, but I can still feel its surface. I can still see its outline. And then there's Husserl's tension, which is a very different one, which is about an object that is not hidden. You are here. You're in front of me. You're not hiding from me. Here you are. It's just that you also have all these accidental features, and what phenomenology is about is getting rid of the accidental features through analysis, saying, I don't need to see Matthew from this side, that's accidental, I can see him from here, I can see him from here. What are the really essential features that make him who he is? How far would he have to change for me to consider him a different person entirely? That's what phenomenology is about. What's the essence of Matthew? What is the essence of him? So there are two different tensions there, and I happen to say that these are what we mean by time and space. So I think that this already gives us a cosmological framework. Time and space are really, for me, just the tension between two kinds of objects and their sensual qualities. You have the real objects that hide, and the sensual qualities hint at it, and then you have the sensual object, which is in experience, which is not real or hidden. How do we know that? Because I can do phenomenological analysis of imaginary things. I can do a phenomenology of a centaur, or a dragon, or the spaghetti monster, or any of these things. I can have a fear about something that's a groundless fear, and I can still do a very patient phenomenological description of that fear, because it's not a real object. It's an object of my experience, but it's there in my experience, so it has to be talked about. So that's time and space. You have real objects and sensual objects, both in tension with their sensual qualities. And now you might ask, what about the real qualities? Are there real qualities? Yes, of course there are. So there are actually two other tensions. Time and space are not alone. Usually debates about cosmology orbit around time and space, and you might add many new dimensions to them. You might say there's just one four-dimensional space-time. You might say there's 11 dimensions in the string that are rolled up, and you can only experience three of them. But they're still talking about space and time. And it occurred to me some years ago when I was working on this model that there's actually that space for the real qualities. There are actually four tensions going on. They're not just time and space. There's also time, space, essence, and eidos. Eidos being one of the Greek words for essence. Essence is simply the relation between the real object and its real qualities. You can get my book, The Quadruple Object, and see all the diagrams if you want. Nice short book. It's a fourfold diagram that labels everything. And the relation between the sensual object and its real qualities is what I call the eidos, because that's Husserl's term. Here's Matthew with his accidental qualities, like blue sweater wearing, seen from left side, hair of exactly this length. Those are accidental, but whatever the real features of Matthew are that he needs to be considered Matthew by me, those are real, because he needs them. If he doesn't have them, I no longer consider him Matthew. It's just that I don't know exactly what those are. It's hard for me to parse those. It's hard for me to describe those. Because I get at them directly, using the mind instead of the senses. I think they cannot never be done directly. You can hint at them. You can allude to them. You can try to figure out the essence of this person, elusively or indirectly. Okay, so that all you have to know is that there's a fourfold diagram, and if you want to say the research program of object-oriented philosophy is simply exploring these four tensions and looking at how they break down in different areas. And aesthetics is perhaps the most interesting of those for our purpose. Aesthetics, I view as the breakdown in the tension between the real object and its sensual qualities. Aesthetics is where you tamper with that relation by splitting the real object from its sensual qualities. Normally, we're not aware of the splits. We're not aware that there might be an object inaccessible hidden behind the properties of the table. There are experiences we can have, though, that create that effect for us, and surprise is one of them. The broken tool is one of them. Artworks are another of these ways. It's another way of showing a separation between the thing and its properties, because you cannot reduce an artwork to its properties in a way that you might be tempted to reduce an electron to its properties. This is one of the differences between scientific and artistic discourse. Sciences are under pressure, at least in times that are not times of scientific revolution. Normal science, as Kuhn calls it, is under pressure to say, we know an electron and we know all of its properties. We can explain what they are. We can discursively, the electron's no longer a mystery. I can tell you what it is. Here's all of its features. You cannot really do that with artworks. You cannot replace the total corpus of Matthew Ritchie's arts with prose descriptions of all of them, unless you're doing this as another layer of art, as a Dadaist, this is all it is kind of thing. No, that you need the things themselves, the objects or the events or the artworks themselves. You need that there. So the arts are already under pressure to create things that cannot be reduced to discursive bundles of qualities. And that's how I see them as similar to philosophy. Philosophy, according to Socrates, this is after the pre-Socratics, of course. The pre-Socratics were reducing things downward. Socrates says you can't do that. Socrates says philosophy is not wisdom, it's a love of wisdom. Philosophy is not a knowledge. You can approach it, you can never get to it. If you think you have it, you're a sophist. Sophia is wisdom. You're a sophist if you think you have it. The philosopher is the one who knows that they don't have it. You can approach it. And the other thing, the interesting that happens with Socrates is Meno says, ask some question about virtue. Can virtue be taught? I think it was. And Socrates says, how can I know what the qualities of virtue are before I know what virtue is? And this is the great paradox of philosophy. Because normally you think you know a thing when you know what its features are. What Socrates is saying is, no, in a sense you have to know that there's a thing there. You can never know what its qualities are. You get the thing indirectly or elusively, which is my answer to people who say that if I think there's this unknowable thing in itself, it's worthless because you can't say anything about it. Well, sure, you can say something about it. Of course you can say something. A great deal of our cognition has to do with this. Metaphor has to do with this, for example. Metaphor is a kind of saying something without saying it. You cannot paraphrase a metaphor in literal terms. This is well known. You cannot say, Max Black gives this boring example. Man is a wolf. He took it from some mediocre poem. Man is a wolf. You cannot explain what that metaphor means. It's a very bad one. You cannot explain what it means. You cannot say what this metaphor can be replaced by is the following prose statements, that humans are vicious and travel in packs and things like that. No, it's stupid if you do that. You cannot paraphrase the metaphor. You cannot, jokes, if you restate jokes in prose terms, you ruin them. This is well known, right? You ruin a joke. If you have to explain the joke to somebody, it's no longer a joke. I used the example of threats in our earlier discussion. A threat is more threatening when it's not spelled out. Godfather's offer you can't refuse is a lot scarier than saying, if you don't do this, I'm going to cut off your horse's head and put it in your bed, which is, you know, scary enough, but it's scarier if it's left open what the consequences might be. There will be serious consequences of your action. It's a lot scarier than giving any determinate threat. Indirect language in general is often more powerful than direct language. And so I completely reject the idea that unless a thing is expressible in terms of a prose statement of discursive properties, that it's a nothing. That's what the sophists claim. The sophists claim there's no reason to study. This is called Meno's paradox. Sophists claim there's no reason to study because either you already know something or you can never know it. You can't look for virtue because if you already know what virtue is, you won't look. And if you don't know what it is, you won't recognize it when you find it. So therefore, there's no point looking for it. That's complete sophistry. By definition, sophists invented that point. What is the case is that you have some idea of what virtue is, and you're approaching it indirectly, and you'll get closer to it, perhaps. There's some understandings of virtue are better than others. And so it's simply not the case that knowledge is either direct or it's nothing. We need indirect knowledge, and that's what the arts, actually art isn't knowledge at all, but it's an indirect access to the thing in the same way philosophy is. All right, so I'm just getting closer to art here. I'll just say one more thing about Heidegger. Last thing I want to say about Heidegger is, this is very important for the rest of what I'm going to say, there's a serious ambiguity in Heidegger. Being in Time, okay, it's supposed to be this one of the hardest philosophical books ever written. It's actually extremely easy. It took me 9 years of reading all of Heidegger's books. There were like 73 volumes at the time. I read them all. To realize Heidegger's extremely simple. He's as simple as anyone since ancient Greece. Being in Time, what does that mean? Being means things withdraw from direct access. The being of the things is what withdraws from direct access. Time is simply the fact that things manifest themselves anyway. There's a threefold structure. Everything is partly hidden, partly revealed, and then that's past. For Heidegger, the past is what's withdrawn. The future is what we make of it, how we look at the thing from our own perspective. And then the intersection of those two is the present, in a sense. So you've got a threefold structure to things. It's not actually that complicated. That's what being and time means. But Heidegger makes a mistake. He's got this concept called the ontological difference. The ontological difference is a fancy way of saying the difference between being and beings. But it has two distinct senses that Heidegger mixes without realizing it, and there are disastrous consequences for him. The good sense of the term is the difference between absence and presence, as I've already talked about. There's a depth to things you cannot exhaust. This is Heidegger's signature insight. This is why he's a historicist as well. You can never get an absolute rational grasp on anything because the reality of things withdraws from access. The reality of things is always deeper. You know, hermeneutics, the science of interpretation, comes out of this because you have to interpret. You can't know something directly, so you have to get at things indirectly, like the way you would a biblical text or a literary text. It's interpretation. That's the good sense of the ontological difference. The bad sense that comes back to haunt him is that he also reads the difference between being and beings tacitly, without saying this explicitly, as a difference between one and many. So being is one and beings are many. And this is what I said is really the key flaw of modernism, this idea that the pre-human world is inarticulate, that it's humans who carve things up into parts. And I'm not kidding. You think I'm kidding? People believe this. Levinas, another of my favorite recent philosophers, says this in his works of the late 1940s. He says that being itself is this kind of rumbling hole that we experience in insomnia. We can't go to sleep, and this being that we can't turn off. And it's human consciousness that breaks it into parts. Levinas says this quite explicitly. You wouldn't think anyone could say that, but he does. And this is one of the key features of modern thought. The idea that the world itself is not articulated, it's humans who carve things up. Things are carved up by our categories. Central to Kant, and Kant is still the most important modern philosopher. We're all in Kant's shadow, whether we like it or not. Now I'll show in a second why I think this leads to big problems, not only for Heidegger, but also for Clement Greenberg. Less so for Marshall McLuhan. I'm going to link these three figures together. I think they go together in an interesting way. What do they all have in common? They're all lovers of the background. They're all despisers of the foregrounds. In Heidegger, we've seen this. Heidegger thinks anything present in consciousness is superficial. You have to get what's deep withdrawn behind that. Marshall McLuhan's case. I take Marshall McLuhan very seriously. He comes in and out of fashion. He's often viewed as a spurious pop intellectual who's best suited for the pages of TV Guide. He's a good joke in Annie Hall, where he comes in and is brought in to insult Woody Allen's hated professor from Columbia, actually, isn't it? That pretentious Columbia instructor is talking about Marshall McLuhan, and Woody Allen goes off camera and makes McLuhan in to insult the guy and tells him he doesn't know what he's talking about. Very funny scene. McLuhan tends to come in and out of fashion as waves of technology come. So when, he was originally the philosopher, the media theorist of the television age, then it was the internet age, and what is it now? He's kind of coming back again. He goes every 15, 20 years, he's back in fashion. His book go out of print, and they come back in print. What is McLuhan's key insight? It's very similar to Heidegger's. Heidegger's insight is that being is that which withdraws behind presence. The reality of things is not their surface. That's Heidegger. McLuhan, it's the medium is the message. That's his most famous phrase. What does the medium is the message mean? It means that the content of media is not important. What's important is the structure of the medium. So don't waste your time arguing about good and bad television shows. What's important is that you're watching television, not listening to the radio. That's important because that's structuring your consciousness differently. The television age structures consciousness differently from the radio age. Forget about the good and bad television. And he's got a fascinating example. I don't know if it's true or not, but the example is that the famous Nixon-Kennedy debate in 1960. McLuhan says that, Kennedy was widely viewed as the winner on television, that Nixon was viewed as the winner by the radio listeners. And if true, that's fascinating. Perhaps Nixon's arguments were actually more cogent in some sense. So the radio listeners were only focusing on that, whereas the appearance of the two, Kennedy looked a lot better, Nixon looked nervous and fidgety, he hadn't shaved, and so he's the loser on television. And McLuhan makes an interesting hypothesis that Hitler could not have succeeded in the television age. It's an interesting thing to think about, that he would have come off horribly on television, you can just see. It's a ranting figure who can be very powerful on the radio as a speaker, but would flop on television. I think there's something to that, probably. I cannot imagine him as a television success. You change the channel immediately, I think. And he also says, McLuhan makes a very extreme point. It's the content of any medium is no more important than the stenciling on the atomic bomb. The graffiti they painted on the atomic bomb. That's what content of medium amounts to. It's not important at all. Very radical claim. Now, paradoxically, and this is going to have impact on Heidegger and Greenberg as well, I'm going to argue. Paradoxically, McLuhan seems like the one who hates the surface, hates the content of the medium more than anybody. He's all about the depth, all about the background structure of the medium. Paradoxically, it's the surface that ends up doing all the work in McLuhan's theory of the world. Why? Because a medium cannot change by itself. All a medium does is hide in the background and structure our consciousness without our being aware of it. Television is back there, conditioning our world without our knowing it. How does a medium change, though? Because television cannot change into a new medium by itself. It's simply static. There's two forces that McLuhan thinks changes media, and they are called reversal and retrieval. And I'll just describe these very briefly. Reversal is when a medium overheats. So a simple example will be that the car begins as a medium of efficient, rapid travel. What does it reverse into? It reverses into traffic jams, the hassle of parking places, of insurance payments, of not being able to get out of your car payment, this sort of thing. The car reverses into a hassle. But what is it that reverses into the hassle? It's not the car itself. The car itself is always a car. What's changing when the car reverses into a hassle is the superficial features of the car that aren't really necessary to it, like the fact that it's a metallic bulk. That was simply a means to an end before. You need the car to have a certain size and a certain metallic hardness to be able to travel at that speed. And what happens is that the supposedly accidental feature of the car, this metallic physicality to it, when you get enough of them, it reverses into the opposite. It reverses into a hassle. But it's a superficial feature of the car that causes that problem. It's not the deep feature of the car itself. So then at a certain point, cars become such a pain that we all give them up and go on to rapid transit. And who knows? Something's going to happen. We'll get sick of it. We can't do this forever. The point is that cars will vanish if they do, or other media have vanished because of superficial problems with the superficial aspects of the medium. So it's the surface where the medium changes. The other example he uses is retrieval, which he directly links to the arts. The retrieval is when a medium becomes obsolete, it turns into a cliche, which means it becomes this kind of visible, obtrusive thing, like landline telephones, or for a while it was vinyl LPs before they became hip again after CDs were introduced. A medium has a period when it is no longer a slickly functioning background medium and becomes something from yesterday. It becomes as boring as last week's newspaper, as McLuhan puts it. stuff from those clunky old iPads from 10 years ago, or iPods, sorry. I don't know what to do with this thing. It's been sitting in my drawer since 2002. This giant, heavy, remember these things? What do you do with that? It's cliche. Just like for a while, vinyl LPs were a cliche for a brief period. And then people started saying, no, there's more of a warm sound to the vinyl. We have to bring back the vinyl. And suddenly they're back. They're brought back as a fashionable thing again. And The Onion has a very funny article about this with lava lamps, about how it's impossible to know where lava lamps are on this cycle. The headline is something like, lava lamps again revert from passé retro kitchen to novel retro camp. You're never quite sure where they are. Go look that article up. It's a killer. For McLuhan, it's artists, primarily. The job of artists is to take old cliches and bring them back to life. Take something that looks old-fashioned or like it's just detritus from the past and bring it back into some new relation to reality. How do you do that? You do that by no longer just treating it as a figure. You have to bring that figure into some relation with the ground. McLuhan uses these figure ground terms. You have to somehow make the old thing believable again in the present context, make it have some effect in the present context. And he thinks it takes real brilliance to do this. It doesn't happen automatically. He calls artists the antennae of our race. They're the ones who take these things and bring them back to life, the revivers. So again, it's for McLuhan, as for Heidegger, it's about bringing the surface into some relation with the background. Otherwise, it's just a superficial surface. So that's McLuhan, and there's more to say about McLuhan. We don't need it here. But just like McLuhan becomes paradoxically dependent on the surface, so does Heidegger. How so? Because Heidegger ends up saying that even though being is so important and beings are superficial, being needs humans, right? Because only with humans, only in this way does being come into various historical shapes of presence. And being needs us for this. And so if being were just being, it would be very boring. That's another way to look at it. So it would just be this withdrawn thing that never does anything. Being is interesting because it comes to presence in different forms, in different historical epochs. And now we're in the age of technology, and it's ruinous, according to Heidegger, whatever. But that's one way in which Heidegger becomes dependent on the surface. Being becomes dependent on its manifestations to humans. The other way, which is one that Heidegger doesn't see, but which I've argued is present in his philosophy, is the fact that if things were withdrawn from each other completely, they would never come into contact. So the surface is where contact takes place. You know, a lot of the Deleuze-inspired philosophies of the last 10 to 15 years have talked about the surface as being sterile and everything happens in the virtual depths. I say the opposite. I say that in a sense, the depth is sterile because it cannot make contact with any other depth. The place where events happen is on the surface, right? If you meet somebody and the person changes your life, that person does not have full, exhaustive understanding of who you are, and you don't have that understanding of yourself either. It's a kind of surface connection you make with the person that leads to a deeper change. Everything interesting happens at the surface. This is known in sociology. They call it the strength of weak links, right? You probably know, some of you know this concept. It's a fascinating concept. It dates way back to the early 70s. The point is that most of your big life changes come from casual acquaintances, not from close friends and lovers and family, because you already know those people. You've already made all possible connections with those people, right? You already have the same interests. You're already looking for the same things. Your big changes come from people you know slightly, who invite you to something or that because you have some peripheral link with that person that connects you with a new circle of people. So there's that idea already there. It's the surface is where interesting connections are made, not the depth. All right, so there's Heidegger and McLuhan. Let's talk about art now. I've deliberately waited a while. And I'm going to talk about, you know, Heidegger's discussion of art has to do with the strife between earth and worlds. And earth, again, has this problem that it's inarticulate. There's one earth for Heidegger. All artworks are a strife between earth and world. They show what's deep behind the thing, that's not present behind the thing, and it locks them in permanent tension. But there's one earth for Heidegger. There's not a different earth for each artwork. Just as there's one plasma for Latour, just as there's possibly one thing in itself for Kant, there's one nature for Descartes. It's a problem. It's a problem that there's this one earth that all artworks are supposedly bringing into play, because it seems to leave very limited opportunity for each artwork to say something different. So let's talk about Clement Greenberg, who I bring into this discussion. I know he's been out of fashion for a long time, but there's some signs that he might be slowly creeping back into fashion. When I gave the keynote at Transmediale in Berlin last February, the only name that got a negative reaction was Clement Greenberg. There was hissing in the audience as soon as I mentioned him. Very fascinating. No negativity about Heidegger or anybody else. It's Clement Greenberg. So he's famous for talking about avant-garde kitsch. That's his most famous essay, probably. But in a way, his more strategic enemy than kitsch is academic arts. Another version of the same thing. It's a strategic adversary. A strategic adversary of the avant-garde for Greenberg. What is academic arts? Well, he tells us in a late lecture he made in Australia. And it fits right with what we've been saying about McLuhan and Heidegger. He says, academic art is art that takes its medium for granted. What he was talking about in his time, of course, is the kind of academic, illusionistic, perspectival, post-Renaissance painting that had reached an incredible point of banality in late 19th century Paris. And this stuff is, makes you want to retch, you know, the naked woman ascending with the cupid surrounding her and shooting over this kind of thing. It's horrible. Taking all the conventions of this kind of painting for granted and simply putting them to work on some banal subject matter. That's the kind of thing we can easily accept as academic art. That's what it usually means. If you Google academic art, that's the kind of stuff that's going to come up. That kind of stuff probably tailed off a lot after the 1920s, of course. But Greenberg says academic art existed long before academies. Academic art is art that does not question its medium. So again, it's art that's too focused on providing content and isn't questioning the way the artwork is structured. Now, here's the thing about Greenberg's use of academic art. He uses it for a surprising array of very different adversaries. It becomes a very general polemical term in Greenberg. Right, so you can see how the salon art of the late 19th century Paris could be called academic. Then he calls it, he applies the term, for example, with surrealism. Surrealism is just academic art. So you can follow his argument, even if you don't agree with it. His argument is that for all of Dali's crazy entities depicted in his canvases, he's just doing the same old 19th century academic perspectival painting, three-dimensional depiction of objects on a landscape, unlike the cubists who are really doing something radical for Greenberg or Matisse. He thinks that Dali's just kind of a throwback. He's an academic. He doesn't really get what avant-garde art is about. Okay, so, all right, you can follow his argument, although it already seems a bit troubling to use the same term for Dali and for this French salon art. There's something he's obviously missing. It gets even a little stranger when he calls Dada academic art. And his argument here becomes a little less sure-footed. What he tells you is there is that Duchamp is not, he says he's not a good artist. He was simply trying to shock people, and he was trying to shock people not in an aesthetic way, but simply by putting something in a gallery context that doesn't belong in a gallery context. So it's a social shock, not an aesthetic one, when he put a urinal in the gallery. He's got actually, I think, seven separate arguments against Duchamp. I don't remember them all at the moment. They're in my article. He also brings in a kind of biographical argument, which is that you see Duchamp try to do cubism and try to do fauvism in his early work, and he fails. He's not very good at it. And so it's kind of interpreted psychologically. He failed at that stuff, therefore he failed at that because he's an academic artist with traditional sensibilities, and therefore he tried to do this pseudo-radical thing, Greenberg says. Well, this seems like a very questionable claim to think that Duchamp, of all people, did not, that he took his medium for granted, right? Because you'd want to say that he's somebody who was trying to call into question the media, precisely, of the artwork. So it doesn't really seem like as good a fit for Greenberg's definition of academic art. And in fact, in some respects, I would say that surrealism and Dada are opposite experiments. They're often packaged together, and of course they have overlapping memberships to some extent. They have a shared, irreverent sense of humor. There are other commonalities you can find in the memberships of the two groups. But in a way, you can look at the two as doing experiments with opposite controls, because Dali needed to attain the traditional medium. Otherwise, you couldn't have pulled off his visual fantasies, right? Like imagine, let's say you had a Dali painting, which instead of using traditional three-dimensional illusionistic depiction, used cubist techniques. A Dali painting done in cubist style. So you have the ghost of Vermeer of Delft, which can also be used as a table. I don't know if you know that one. It's the guy with a really long leg that has a tray on it with the drinks in it, and propped up by a crutch. You know, great typical Dali image. What if you did that in a kind of analytic cubist style? It would be just incoherently too much going on at once, right? Intellectually way too busy. You'd see this weird image depicted in this cubist way, and it's just too much is going on at once. You need the traditional medium for the variation in content to become visible, in other words. Whereas the opposite would be true as well, that if Duchamp's ready-mades had not been simple objects, but had been complicated objects, this also would have confused us, right? So instead of the urinal or the bottle rack or the bicycle wheel, it had been 78-part electrical generator or something like that. You'd put some really complicated piece of machinery in the gallery. It would be, again, doing too many things at once. It would be trying to innovate in form and content simultaneously. And It's a unique, in a way, these two schools are trying to perform experiments with opposite controls. And notice also that the Cubist paintings, these are Greenberg's heroes. This is the great, analytic cubism is the greatest 20th century art movement for Greenberg, for reasons we'll get into in a second. Notice that these paintings are always a very simple objects, like, you know, violin or candlestick. They need that simple content in order to innovate in the form. It would be too confusing if it were an object that were too complicated, or a complicated historical landscape. You know, Napoleon vanquishing such and such at such and such a battle, done in analytic cubist style, would be too much going on again. So, what is going on? In what sense does Greenberg link with Heidegger and McLuhan? Well, for him, it's that the content of the painting is superficial. The content of the painting is what he calls literary content in most cases. It's something that doesn't belong in painting. It's something that belongs in literature. If you're trying to depict a story or something like this, you're in danger of degenerating into academic arts. What art should be about for him is the flat canvas background. That's the medium. In order to not be an academic artist, in order to be aware of your medium, you need to be aware, for Greenberg, that it's a flat canvas, and you need to stop trying to plow this exhausted field of illusionistic, three-dimensional post-Renaissance painting. And he thinks Cubism does this very well, and he thinks one of the ways Cubism does this very well is by covering the canvas pretty well. And that gets me to another person he criticizes, not as an academic artist primarily, but as a provincial artist. That's Kandinsky, another of his least favorite ones. He writes in this astonishingly brutal obituary article about Kandinsky, who just died a couple weeks earlier, that he's a terrible example for younger artists. He was a great artist for only a very brief window of time, and he's actually a provincial and an academic painter. He says there are two kinds of provincials in this essay, very interesting essay. One kind of provincial is the one who lives in a backwater and paints in an old style that's old-fashioned and way behind the times. Okay, that's not so interesting. The other kind of provincial, for him, is someone who seems to be right in the thick of the avant-garde movements, but is misunderstanding it. What's Kandinsky's misunderstanding? He makes an interesting claim. I don't think it's fair, but his claim about Kandinsky is that Cubism was really about the flat canvas for Greenberg, whereas Kandinsky misinterpreted Cubism as being about abstraction. And so Kandinsky fills his canvas with all kinds of abstract shapes, and yet they have academic reminiscences, Greenberg says, because they're floating in this space, and it kind of creates this perspectival depth that we should have gotten beyond an avant-garde painting. It's just, they're abstract shapes, but they're also in three-dimensional space in a way that they shouldn't be. And that's why he's a provincial. In my article, I also talk about another kind of provincial, which would be Cézanne, who, despite being a provincial by Greenberg's definition, is actually a huge success by Greenberg's own admission. You can read my article when it comes out if you want to read about Cézanne. Anyway, here's my point about the flat canvas. The flat canvas has the same problem as Heidegger's Earth, which is that it's unified. And I've said this is one of the main problems of modernism, is that it tends to treat the background as a unified thing that is cut into pieces only at the foreground. Only the surface cuts the world into parts, the world in itself is deep. In what sense is Greenberg a thinker of depth? Because you think, okay, he's about flatness. All right, but still, the flat canvas is deeper than the content of the painting. So in that sense, he is a thinker of depth. It's just this unified flat surface that needs to be somehow reflected in the content of the painting. The painter somehow needs to wink or squint or show that they're aware that they're not really working in a three-dimensional medium, they're working with a flat medium. That's the sign of an advanced painter for him. Now, I think this has consequences for Greenberg in a couple of ways. One of these ways is, of course, you can't keep on doing this forever. You know, at a certain point, art moved on. I think he's a fantastic critic, a wonderful writer. How much flatter can you get after a certain point in abstract expressionism, right? Then he's later defending, you know, Nolan and Olitsky and some other people, but at a certain point you're going to run out of ways to make the painting flatter. Just like Derrida trying to make philosophy less realist. I should explain this. There's a book by Lee Braver called A Thing of This World, The History of Continental Anti-Realism. And he treats all of continental philosophy as this history of greater and greater anti-realism, which Braver praises. It's great, we're getting away from this naive fantasy of a real world outside of thought. And he kind of triumphalistically details this development from Kant all the way up through Derrida. But then Derrida so thoroughly fumigates realism in the last chapter that you wonder, is philosophy now over? Did Derrida just simply end philosophy? And there's no other place to go? I would ask Greenberg the same thing. At what point painters realize now that the canvas is flat, where are you going to go? And so he became increasingly irrelevant in the eyes of many people starting in the 1960s. But there's another point that's not often noted, which is that he's also not especially relevant when you go backwards in time. What do you do with Greenberg when you go before Manet, for example? How can Greenberg's principles distinguish between varying levels of quality in the Renaissance? He makes value judgments about those periods, but you can't really apply his principles and say that, you know, Raphael is worse than Piero della Francesca because he's not as aware of the flat. I mean, that would be absurd. That's just not a relevant category by which to distinguish those artists. So that's a problem with the undercutting literary content in the paintings is not going to, it's only going to get you so far. It's only going to work for a specific period of modernism in painting. It's not going to be a universalizable aesthetic theory. And Heidegger, too, is also way too happy to undercut beings. Heidegger not only has contempt for presence, he has contempt for individual beings, right? Heidegger thinks that as soon as you talk about the effect of individual things, you're superficial. So Heidegger thinks it was superficial to talk about the Hiroshima atomic bomb. He says, oh, that's just the surface event. No, the real disaster happened in ancient Greece when being was forgotten. So you can't really talk about the importance or effect of individual things. Heidegger calls this ontic as opposed to ontological. It's superficial. It's not worthy of a philosopher to talk about individual things. Again, I think he's confusing individual things with the surface. You can have individual things that are not surface. You can have individual things that are deeper than they seem to be, and are nonetheless important actors. This is the reason I think I picked up on the tour so enthusiastically, is that I was a recovering Heideggerian. And Heidegger has nothing but contempt for individual things, whereas Latour is just frolics about individual things and writes about trains and chemicals and wastebaskets and laboratories and, you know, the price of apricots in Paris. So we brought him to Cairo and he lectured on the price of apricots in Paris. And my colleagues were horrified. You know, this isn't philosophy, but it really is. It's philosophy. But what does Latour do? Latour makes the same mistake that I said most modernism makes. He posits this plasma as this inarticulate background that everything else needs, and that everything else must refer to. So, if modernism, then, according to this reading, is what belittles content, modernism is what looks to the medium as the message, what looks to the being behind the beings, what looks to the flat canvas behind the literary content of the painting. If this entire movement has been about belittling content, then we have to find some way of recovering the content. And not just in the way of exploding the frame again and again, as in Dadaism, because that's probably been done for too long now as well. There has to be a way to bring the content back, but not in the old, naive way. Content must be used as a method for allowing the individual elements to point to individual backgrounds and not just point to one flat canvas, one earth. And I've made the same case about literature. What's the problem in literary criticism over the last decades? Well, if you oversimplify a bit, you can say, first there were the new critics who say that poem or literary work is an autonomous entity cut off from its environment, so you don't need to talk about the biography of the author or the socioeconomic conditions under which the work was produced. The text has an internal logic, and you can look at that logic. But notice that in the end, that ends up becoming a holism too, because what they end up saying is that the literary work is a perfect machine with all the pieces affecting each other. And so if you change one word somewhere in the poem, it's a different poem. That seems to me absurd. We have varying texts for many literary works. We don't say that there's different Dantes every time a different text appears from some Italian academic, right? So there needs to be a way of treating artworks not as holistic, but as made up of autonomous parts that can be moved around without changing the artwork as a whole. That's one problem with literary criticism. Then there was the reaction to this, new historicism, which said that literary texts are not fundamentally different from other kinds of texts. You cannot cut off a literary text from its surroundings. You have to treat literary texts the same way you treat prison registers or real estate documents, and you have to treat them as conditioned by the socioeconomic conditions under which they were written and so forth. And this has the other problem, which is that you can't explain how literary works can travel across time and space, which to some extent they can. It's not the case that Shakespeare was only understood in his time in Elizabethan England. You can transport him and he can be enjoyed in many of the places. This is sort of the conservative arguments, right? The great books arguments that you can move things around, but there's some truth in that as well, that the thing is not holistically reducible to its context. So anyway, more generally, this is my last note card. The challenge for us in all these fields would be to rethink content in a non-relational way. The object is that which is deeper than any relation to other things. And by the way, I'm not against relations. I'm against the idea that relations is all there is. I'm in favor of symbiosis. I just added this to my card now because we were talking about symbiosis, is how things change. Some people claim that I can't explain how objects change. Objects are what they are and they'll always stay the same. Levi Bryant says this, for example. Levi Bryant says that since I think real things have real qualities, the things can never change. Actually, I decided that he was right. I don't think we change. The things that we call changes in our lives are usually symbiosis. What were the big things that happened in your life? It's not usually something internal. It's usually something involving the fusion of you with something else, whether it's another person, an institution, a favorite author, a favorite artist. There are these jumps in your life where things change, and it generally happens with either a connection or the breaking of a connection with something else. And one of the really stimulating books I've read in the last 15 years was Lynn Margulis' Symbiotic Planet. She unfortunately died a few years ago. And she's the one who theorized in the late 60s, when it was laughed at, that the cell is actually a symbiosis of pre-cellular organisms that started to live together in a kind of modus vivendi, and then they eventually became a stable unit called a cell. My understanding is that this is now basic biology. It's in the textbooks. And I think it's an interesting model, even though the overextension of the model has been criticized, but I think it's an interesting model, this idea that what really changes in the world is symbiosis between objects. So I'm in favor of that. But I'm not in favor of relationizing everything so that it's nothing more than its effects, nothing more than its socioeconomic conditions of production and so forth. And this, in closing, is what I mean by the search for the fourth table. Because the third table is that thing in between the two. It's not reducible either to its parts or to its contextual effects. The fourth table would be what we construct as a messenger to the fourth thing. It's the third thing. The fourth table would be the artistic depiction of the table or the philosophical depiction of the table that helps us get indirectly at the third table that's hidden that we can never access. So I know that's a lot there. I like to provide big buffets where you can all take the food you like, chew on the things you like. I will stop there and leave it to Bettina to respond, and then we'll have questions, I guess.
Semi-comical has an element of coincidence not to be underestimated. I underestimated it in any case with my written response.
So as a respondent, Bettina will have twice as long. And then we expect three times as long for the Q&A. So sometime around midnight, we should all get out of here. The spirits will bring in food. The doors will be locking in that 30 seconds.
So maybe I'll start because the images come in a little later. Anyway. So Graham, thank you so much for the tour de force. I truly underestimated it. I want to start by making some comments on what you've written in your essay on Greenberg and Duchamp, which you were kind enough to share with me earlier, and which I thought was the core of what you would present here. So you'll see a lot of relation to the later part of the talk and what I've done.
I'll just tell the audience that's coming out in the online journal Speculations in the next couple of months. There are three right now, four is coming out, and that'll be in five. Bettina's seen it.
I've also written about these two figures in my book, Proper Populace, Art Between High and Low. I want to say, first of all, that your paper is dense and complex. Well, your talk, not your paper, but also the paper, but ultimately open-ended and speculative. And this is what makes it so exciting. As I see it, you're taking Clement Greenberg's criticism as a model that might once again be interesting or relevant, not because of its strict emphasis on formalism, but because he's known to us as the art critic who decreed what was right and what was wrong, and who therefore tried to predict what was to come next in art, or should not come next in art. His judgments were moralistic, i.e., as you said, calling Kandinsky a dangerous influence for young artists, or describing Duchamp as a dead end. So, essentially, you're looking to his viewpoint as a kind of inspiration, I thought. And then yourself posing the question of what might come next and how we might get to this next step in the evolution of art and its criticism. You're right, quote, over the past decade there has been a growing sense that Greenberg is readable once again, while Duchamp's legacy was perhaps on the verge of becoming overexploited, end quote. And this may be because Greenberg was writing from a point of view of what he saw as, sorry, And this may be because Greenberg was writing from a point of what he saw as exhaustion. In his view, Duchamp was entirely played out and we needed to find a new direction. He was seeing land art, conceptual art, and minimal art as basically bankrupt derivatives of Duchamp. That might not be something that we agree with now, but it may be that 40 years later, we can finally sort of come to the same conclusions as Greenberg. Okay, you weren't right about the art of the 70s, but now we've caught up, because now everything feels exhausted to us too. And recognizing, of course, that this feeling of exhaustion, that things have become overexploited, is perennial. I still wouldn't necessarily agree that the period since the 1960s is neo-dada, a neo-dada period, i.e. Duchampian. Because I think that view, which was Greenberg's, leaves out the influence of Warhol, whom he couldn't really deal with, and who shifted the terrain again. But on the other hand, Warhol, like Duchamp, is another strain of art whose legacy may be overexploited, as you put it. So I can't give an answer to the question of what is coming next, but I want to contribute to the discussion by coming from a slightly different angle, which is to fill in another side of Duchamp's work, which I think has really come to influence art of the last few decades more so than the ready-made, in fact. This is his play with information and documentation, with the very reception of his own work through printed and editioned representations. It's an interference into art history. This is something that basically falls outside of Greenberg's investigation and isn't really addressed by the six-point critique that you mentioned, Graham. Just to recap those points, Duchamp rejects quality or taste, is primarily interested in shock value, uses transgressive material, privileges the concept, overestimates his own radicality, and is an academic artist, which you talked about a little longer, who takes his medium for granted. The thing is, these points of critique seem to make sense only as long as we focus on the ready-mades and other objects as objects per se, and we ignore their context, the discourse, their perverse histories, and everything that Duchamp worked so hard to put into place, a practice which is now much more common because of his work. As an example, let's take a look at the most famous, and as such the most exhausted, ready-made, the fountain. Few people saw the original fountain in 1917. Like almost all the ready-mades, the original had gone missing, its dimensions never recorded. Never exhibited and lost or destroyed almost immediately, the fountain was actually created through Duchamp's media manipulations rather than through the creation myth of his hand selecting it in the showroom. The status conferring and, for Greenberg, would be shocking gesture to which the ready-mades are often reduced. A week after the Society of Independent Artists refused to exhibit the work, Duchamp transported the urinal to Alfred Stieglitz's 291 gallery, where Stieglitz photographed it, as you can see up there, under theatrical lighting in front of an expressionist painting. This is the only remaining visual trace of the original fountain. This photograph has been reproduced in countless publications and also served as the model for the edition of Fountain produced in 1964 by Arturo Schwarz in collaboration with Duchamp. A critical commentary on the work, which apart from the photographic reproduction is all that allows for its inscription into what we might call the archive, appeared a month later without attribution in the second and final issue of The Blind Man, a journal published, not coincidentally, by Duchamp. So the object disappears, but its semi-factional documentation and narrative produced a guarantee, a sort of shortcut to history through photography and writing. With the original lost, the question of what is a copy, what is an additioned object, wherein lies the authorization of executing a work, are raised for the first time and remain complex and ambiguous. I'm showing here, a black surface, which was supposed to be something else. Well, I was going to show you four photographs of the original fountain as photographed by Stieglitz, then the fountain as selected in 1950 by the gallerist Sidney Janis in Paris at the request of the artist, looking quite different, and then in 1953 another object that we don't see right now, selected for sale to benefit a friend of the artist, and one more urinal we don't see from 1963 selected by Ulf Linde 10 years later for the Moderna Museet Stockholm for Duchamp's first great retrospective. And last, also invisible, 1964, the addition of 8 replicas produced under the artist's supervision from the Stieglitz photograph. This is the one closest to the original, but still would have shown various slight differences. This picture is, on the right-hand side, a papier-mâché model that Duchamp made of the urinal for the miniaturized edition. And then on the left is the executed edition in miniature of the fountain. In Fountain's elegant model, the artwork does not occupy a single position in space and time. Rather, it is a palimpsest of gestures, presentations, and positions, as Seth Bright suggests in his essay Dispersion. He writes, quote, Duchamp distributed the notion of the fountain in such a way that it became one of art's primal scenes. It's transubstantiated from a provocative objet d'art into, as Brotas defined his Musée des Ergles, a situation, a system defined by objects, by inscriptions, by various activities, quote end. In short, it turned art into discourse. Duchamp made sure to photograph the original, to publicize it, to archive it, and then to totally twist the trail. Had anyone previously done such work with copies and editions within the realm of high art? Once art defines itself as an activity primarily manifested in the larger domain of distribution, it encounters new and illuminating problems, as in the case of Duchamp's editions of his ready-mades created with Arturo Schwarz. Things declared to be ready-mades were, mere decades later, no longer industrially produced or untraceable. The objects in question thus had to be reconstructed by hand and at great expense from sketches or photographs. This is the miniature version. Fountain was reproduced by a Milanese ceramicist with the aid of Stieglitz's photograph of the original. After Duchamp had authorized the design for the copies, the so-called genuine copies of the ready-mades were now, nearly 40 years after they had been selected from among ordinary objects, seemingly conventional sculptures, handcrafted to imitate mass-produced articles. As Martha Buskirk has noted, quote, for the ready-mades, Duchamp had developed new ways of establishing authorship that would operate in tandem with their testing of the boundaries of the work of art. If Duchamp's initial gesture of choosing the ready-made referred to mass production, the later forms of reproduction through which the ready-made cycled secured their status as art. End quote. From 1930 to 1940, Duchamp spent his creative energy mainly on the reconstruction of miniature replicas of his earlier works. Most of the pieces from that period took the form of multiples. La Bottom-Valise, up there, an edition of 300 completed in 1941, included miniature replicas of the ready-mades, reproductions of the works in glass or celluloid, colotype prints of the paintings, drawings and commercial prints, some black and white, others hand-colored, as well as photographs of the ready-mades, of the optical apparatus, and of Duchamp's studio, all manipulated in various ways. In order to reproduce some of them, he had to visit his collectors and take notes or even buy back the chunk check he had given to his dentist. The notes in Duchamp's 1934 green box, in an edition of 300, were thought to be the only extant notes about the large glass. Duchamp, however, had more. 32 years after publishing the green box, he produced the white box, or à l'infinitif, in an edition of 150 in 1966. Which contained additional notes. These were translated and typographically transferred into English by Richard Hamilton and Ecker Bonk, a so-called typo-translation published as a book in 1967, also under the authorization of Duchamp. So these are a couple of notes from the white box, and I'm showing them to you because you can see how he controlled what was in the box. He would like rip a note apart into two halves to just hide whatever he felt was not relevant or should remain private. This is a photo of, it's a strange photo. And I think it's probably based on a collage where he photographed his various ready-made ideas and was playing around with them, putting them on a photo of his studio and also projecting himself as a shadow in the corner and just sort of seeing what they might look like as unconventionally hung objects. And then photographing this collage and making it into well, as if these things were hovering, it's sort of like a note to himself. But today it's sort of like artists would Photoshop their work into spaces that they would like to see their work, or just to figure out how to show something. I want to stop and point out that all these examples don't overcome Greenberg's critiques. Obviously, Greenberg would have seen all this as a confirmation of his doubts about the direction Duchamp was taking art. But this is how Duchamp allowed the work to enter a larger conversation and to circulate through cultural realms way beyond the exhibition hall or gallery. Greenberg underestimated the power of this. He may have been right about the eventual waning of the ready-made as a model, but there were a lot more powerful tools in Duchamp's toolbox. The way he made manuals for his own work, the status of the copy and the editioned object, the tweaked reproduction of one's work, the way art can turn into discourse, his thoughts on the fourth dimension and the other quasi-mathematical and quasi-scientific aspects, and so on. In comparison, if you look at a painting by Pollock, you can admire the work, you can take something away in terms of attitude, experience, or freedom, but there aren't so many concrete strategies to take away and use in your own work. It's not, in fact, so much about objects now, but about images. And now that we are in the realm of the digital, the computational space, as Matthew said, the image can migrate and transform much more rapidly, and with all sorts of new forms. This is today's overexploited legacy of Duchamp, not the ready-mades as a shocking new sculptural form. It's Duchamp's work of documentation, information, altered photographs, forgeries, identities, narrativizing, and transferals. I want to switch gears now. Graham, the last sentence of your essay is, "What outmoded provincial might emerge as the Cézanne of the coming era?" You're referring to Cézanne going back to pick up perspectival space and trying to synthesize it with contemporary strategies, and pointing to this as a possibly interesting new approach or direction for artists today, who retrieve passed over elements and basically run them through a contemporary filter. There's a case study I'd like to share. I want to go back to the 1970s and look at certain pieces by Robert Whitman. Whitman is not exactly overlooked, but certainly not as well known as he should be. He's mainly known for his performances from the 1960s and 70s, and his cinema pieces from as early as 1963, in which installations of everyday objects, like a shower, sink, or window, become screens onto which he projected films showing these objects in use. He also worked over many years with Billy Cleaver and the Experiments in Art and Technology group, which brought him in contact, crucially, with the Xerox machine. A Xerox machine is interesting as a transitional technology. It isn't based on a chemical development process, like a camera. It doesn't really refer to the world of photography. It's electronic, it's electrostatic. It sweeps across whatever you place on its flatbed and puts it together in one image. So we're just one step away from the scanner, which is what's interesting here. The contemporary artist, well, this is a fish, obviously. Whitman put on a scanner when he had a fellowship with Xerox in 1974, and he scanned all kinds of things, food and like everyday stuff. The contemporary artist collaboration, Guyton Walker, made up of Wade Guyton and Kelly Walker, uses the scanner as one of their main tools. And a whole component of their work comes out of something Whitman did in 1974, when he had a fellowship at Xerox. The photocopier was not a common artist tool at the time. You had to have this kind of access. What Whitman started doing was Xeroxing sliced fruit and fish and other food. So here's a poster from 1976 where he uses two of these Xeroxes of an orange and a lime, which I was working on the publications at DIA back then, and we put together the first larger monograph on his work. So we put the sliced fruit on the cover. To return to the present, Guyton and Walker both saw the 2003 Whitman exhibition at DIA, where Wade was working. Oh, sorry. Here's the poster, which includes a sliced lime placed on the flatbed of the Xerox and turned into a flat graphic element. And this turned directly into a series of work in which Guyton Walker started putting sliced fruit, particularly limes, through their scanner. What's different now is that the scanner brings the fruit not simply to the page, but into the digital space, where you can do all kinds of things to the file. So this is actually a file that they produced, which they then used to print on various surfaces and objects. The file is open to manipulations and applications in various formats and to printing on different kinds of objects and surfaces. You can see here the naked file as information, first of all, a Photoshop document. Here's the image printed by inkjet onto sheet rock, in front of which are various canvases onto which they printed both digitally and with silk screen. The ubiquitous building material itself part of an installation, sheet rock that is. Here on a paint can, here laminated onto a table. The artists are not the new Cézannes, by the way, but I am interested in taking up your idea of past elements that have a new relevance when they are brought to contemporary strategies that create a strange synthesis. And I want to leave the image of this table on the screen because it brings to mind another question for me. I wonder how, in thinking about the strangeness of how the scanner takes in the world of objects and how these images are output through printing technologies in so many adaptable ways in order to cover the world of objects, we might, through artworks, possibly approach an understanding of your notion of the third table. This is a concept you wrote about and just spoke about in a notebook for Documentas 100 Notes, 100 Thoughts publication series. I don't want to discuss the notion too much in detail since you are here with us to do that, but I will summarize briefly. The first table, as I understand, is the one that scientists would call the real table, which is a collection of material described in terms of the laws of physics. The second table is the table that humanists would find more real, and this is a table as we know it, every day, a familiar object inscribed in social use and custom, and so on. You, however, say that neither of these tables is the real table, that there's a third table, possibly a fourth table, which lies between the two, and which may belong to the culture of the arts. It is a table that is, to some degree, unknowable. It's a philosophical artistic table, and I leave it at that. In closing, I'm hoping that in the discussion we can go a bit more into how an object-oriented philosophy might somehow change how we think about art, what art is, where its place is, and where it may be going.
When I said surrealism is doing what Dada is doing, Party Culture isn't challenging the frame and challenging the genre of art as much as it is providing powerful content. Mm. And Warhol's doing that too. Warhol isn't really innovating as the medium. He's not doing what Duchamp did in that sense. He's giving us new content. It's familiar content, but it's new in the art context.
Well, Liam Gillick made it. I felt it was a difficult to grasp point last night in his lecture.
Okay.
But it was that when artists encounter technology, there's sort of common interpretation of that as the technology gets incorporated or a strategy gets incorporated into the studio practice.
Yes.
Liam was at great pains to sort of articulate that the technology becomes the production. And I wasn't quite exactly sure what he meant by that, but in the sense that what artists are doing is presenting the technology itself. So video artists are not just using video technology to remake either academic or new ideas. They're actually, as like a Diana stated, it's as much about 30 televisions or 19 pipe as it is about what is on those televisions.
It sounds like McLuhan.
That's why I brought it up, because when you were talking about that, and you see Duchamp's use of photography, which was, of course, a technology that evolved in his lifetime from newspapers. The archive itself was something that had come to be as a technology.
Right.
So knowable and usable, both as a carrier, but also as a technology unto itself. So I just wanted to interject that into that, because I think that's kind of a vital point that you're addressing, is that the emerging depth of a technology as an object, external to its ability to be a tool.
Was Lyon arguing that this should be the way art moves going forward, or is he saying this is an exhausted strategy?
He's just saying that it's a slight misconception to think that artists seize on new technologies as a way to make a new thing. Mm-hmm. That it's more that the new technologies show up and we sort of push them around. They are as much content as the content the technology carries.
Did you mean as hardware or as a filter?
I think both. Uh-huh. I think that they're slightly indistinguishable for artists. Like this computer to me is like not
just the computer. It's like it's, it becomes like your arm or something. Because we're not very bright, so we're kind of like, you know, me have computer, like art is kind of part of our thing. Like we would do that with the, back in the cave with the charcoal. It's like me have hand make art. So there is a kind of when technologies get integrated and cross over those boundaries, is I think it's less what's a Heideggerian term? Maybe less withdrawal for us. We're less, we find it a bit less withdrawal than the historical context might imply. I don't know.
Except the thing you're talking about technologies being presented as art, almost suggests the opposite. Because this is not something everyone realizes when they go in and see the theory televisions. They're focusing on the content, probably. So there is a withdrawal of the medium. Unless the artist goes to great lengths to showcase the medium itself.
Yeah, and well, this is where it kind of gets interesting. I had not thought of this till Liam brought it up. I'd always thought of technology as this kind of servant. The historical record produces a new technology and artists then adopt it, you know, either before or often much later than everybody else in a stupid way.
Or maybe thinking about pike is useful then, because it's these towers, cathedral-like towers, of, and the image really swooshes over the overall surface of all combined monitors, not individual.
Certainly he's an artist I think about in context with that kind of warmer, with that kind of inanity of the image as well, like the very intentional I'm with this kind of, and Warhol, the inane image, whereas Duchamp is a different case part of the time. Part of the time he's presenting himself as a super sophisticated Frenchman who's thinking about non-Euclidean geometry, and part of the time it's just this thing I found, you know, I found, you know, the complexity of that. There's a kind of phony.
Yeah, the more complex one feels more 19th century French than the more vanilla one.
Yeah, to more or less American one way. Yeah, so questions? Two questions, or is that just two fingers?
I just wanted to say that what you were talking about, this fellow who Greenberg? It happened that I was at Bell Laboratories in the 60s, and I happened to be with Billy Kluver with experiments in art and technology, and also we had artists pouring in and playing with our technology. And there's this fellow, I can't quite remember his name, he was a successor to McLuhan, and I think he wrote something called Empires of the Mind or something like that. But anyway, what he was talking about was that you don't deal with this technology. You deal with the next technology, and then you create things within this technology. And what was going on, Kluver, with the labs, with all that stuff, when we had the artists coming in, was everybody was playing with the next technology, and they had never seen it before. So because you've never seen it before, you automatically were creating in a way that was outside any previous perimeter you had. And so you automatically were outside of this thing you're talking about with Greenberg. It's that you automatically become a creative person because you're playing with stuff that you don't know what you're playing with. And you're in another universe. And you then do things and you have no idea even what's about to happen. You're almost in an accidental art world.
So the thesis would be that novelty of medium generates novelty of content kind of automatically.
Or novelty of context, maybe, rather than content.
Really? Context?
I was saying novelty of media. I was in the McLuhan world that you were talking about.
Right, you're saying that the new medium automatically generates creativity.
For those that are given the opportunity to play with it and be creative. I've always believed that every human being's creative, mm-hmm. and they're just inadvertently not able to play with the stuff the way some people are.
I think what's interesting about experiments in modern technology was how uncreative a lot of the artists were using this new technology. They were just actually making the same things that they always made with now back and forth. before. I mean, someone like James Turrell didn't actually make anything. He just went into an anechoic chamber and listened to his heartbeat for weeks at a time, you know, and that led to a lot of different work. But someone like Robert Indiana didn't make anything innovative at all. It was just a kind of regurgitation of his of what he did.
Well, and to that point, I mean, I think one of the great sort of unwritten stories is like the, in the early part of the 19th century, a lot of the imagined possibilities of technology were mapped out pretty quickly. They were articulated, you know, in something like the glass bead game. The glass bead game by Hermann Hesse. They talk about a sort of interactive game that the whole world plays that subsumes newspapers and magazines and all this stuff. There's no mention of the technology itself. So when you get to the experiments in art and technology, I was just in California reading the correspondence. There's a tremendous funny interplay between the artists who are sort of asking for something they expect. They're basically looking for these. And the engineers are like, well, what I can do, especially in the armory show, is turn the lights on and off in a certain sequence. And that's pretty much pushing it. Like, they build the first, like, lifetime theatrical switchboard that can turn lights on and off on stage. And the engineer's like, that, and that's, you know, we're really going places now. We've got the blue lights to come on off to the red lights. And we've built this as circuit diagrams. And the artists are like, I was hoping for, you know, like, World War III. But instead, I'll get this chick in a silver spacesuit to come out and hold up a sign. This is like Eugen Fallstrom or someone saying World War III. So it's kind of this disconnect between the anticipation of a future enactment of a technology that they've sort of understood from a literary context, and in a way that kind of, as you said, the creativity, the engineers are going full tilt, and the artists are occupying both the past and a future that was imagined in the distant past.
Yeah, I want to think two things at once here. On the one hand, it's true that when you pick up a new gadget, it does unleash all this euphoria, exploring new possibilities. And at the same time, I think a lot of times it takes a while for a medium to catch up to its potential. I'm thinking of a talk I saw by Peter Greenaway in the Netherlands where he was complaining that the whole history of film has simply been presenting novels, basically, and has not really discovered its true filmic possibilities yet. And that's what he's trying to do, apparently, and not present stories, because that's what novels are supposed to do. So I would agree that the new medium somehow does unleash some energy, but then wouldn't you still want to distinguish between good and bad uses of those media? Isn't there still a difference in quality? It might be true that everyone's creative, but it might not be true that everyone's creative with the new mediums at the same degree.
Oh, it was Innes, by the way, that I meant, about...
More of a predecessor to McLuhan, actually. Yeah.
Well, but then he wrote about stuff for, right. I think, subsequent to some of the McLuhan things. Yeah. And what... I think that there was criticism in every direction. Warhol, I remember, wrote an article in the Times saying that the Nine Evenings was the most important art event of the 20th century, and that was a riot. But the thing that was going on was that it told people they would have all this stuff to play with. I mean, this was an extraordinary event that was going on for all the artists, and these are the artists that came out of the Black Mountain School, which was an experimental school. They were the same people who then were coming in contact with tons of people, and those people were finding out what they would be able to play with. And it just, I think that there was nothing about non-originality going on. The artists made it original. They did extraordinary things with practically no technology. I mean, you know, they had very little. And at the same time, one of the things that really amazed me about one of the performances was they had a dance performance going on. And what they did was they started knocking out the lights. And then they had this big screen up. And slowly you began to focus on the screen and you were no longer seeing what was in front of you. And it just was a kind of symbolic event for what we were becoming as human beings. Because that's what our whole life is about. We're seeing everything on television. We no longer see anything that's actually going on. It's like a new virtual world. And if you make contact with humans, you're now saying I like or I don't like or whatever. And you're not even in contact with anybody anymore. And everybody thinks they're in deep contact. I mean, these were amazing commentaries that were going on back then using next to no technology.
So and I'd like to address in terms of that emergence, the question where you briefly mentioned Lovecraft in your talk. And there's a kind of...
Did I?
Yes, for one second, right?
Yeah,
Lovecraft was mentioned,
chair.
Right? See, look, everyone was like, yeah, all the ears pricked up when you mentioned Lovecraft.
But I did, I just don't remember doing it.
And there's another context, you've mentioned this difference between sort of reduction or taking away and an additive reduction. I'd like to talk a little bit about that, especially in the context of this notion of surface relations and depth.
Right. Well, I've written a whole book on Lovecraft, as you know. It's called Weird Realism. Just like Lovecraft wrote for weird tales and wrote weird fiction. Should have a weird realism. Realism is usually viewed as the boring philosophy. So you have like the sober middle-aged people come in and stop experimentation in philosophy by saying you have to focus on the facts. I compare it to being like restaurant inspectors rather than restaurants. That's what realism is. So weird realism means realism is not translatable into knowledge. What I did with Lovecraft in that book is I tried to show that there are two tensions at work in Lovecraft that are the same as the two tensions I talked about in Rousseau and Heidegger. And you see this in Lovecraft's style. On the one hand, Lovecraft is the great author of describing things without describing them. You'll often say Cthulhu, and I know I'm pronouncing that wrong. Lovecraft didn't pronounce it the way himself, but I don't want to try to do the however he did it. I'll just say Cthulhu. Someone I know said Cthulhu's not scary because an octopus or a dragon with an octopus head is not scary. All right, but that's not how he describes Cthulhu. He describes him as, in my frenzied imagination, I imagine that perhaps it was not dissimilar to, he has all these hesitations, not that dissimilar to a grotesquely hideous human outline, not unlike, with wings not unlike that of a dragon and pulpy tentacle, surrounded by a pulpy and tentacled head. So he's making the description, but then he's also withdrawing it at the same time. He's saying that's just an allusion to it. I can't really get at it, but that's sort of what it was like. And that's what makes it scary. The fact that dragon with octopus head doesn't do the job. It's something much worse than that. And you find this throughout Lovecraft's fiction. I found, I don't know how many examples, when I went through all the main stories. Then there's this other stylistic tension in Lovecraft that's not about depth and that I associate with Husserl, which is where he says, oh, it's no problem, I can describe this, but then it's impossible to visualize. And you usually get this in his architectural descriptions, which, like the Antarctic city that they see in At the Mountains of Madness. He never says it was indescribable and it was somewhat like, no, he just says it was these 19 things. It was, beetling table-like constructions with multitudinous slabs of five-pointed stars arranged in curious clusters and, it just goes on impossibly with this list of details that you cannot possibly integrate into a visual image as you're reading it, which is why I think it would be very hard or impossible to paint Lovecraft scenes. They would miss the point. You certainly cannot paint Cthulhu because he's saying it's not that.
Many have tried.
Yeah, many have tried and they're not. Right. So there's those two tensions going on, and this is what the funny thing about speculative realism is that none of us like any of the same authors in philosophy. There's not one shared hero. The only shared hero is H.P. Lovecraft, who we all read independently before we knew each other. It's really bizarre, isn't it? Considering one of the guys is French, and one is Scottish-French, one American. We different parts of the world, roughly the same age, and yet we were all into Lovecraft for different reasons. He's the new Holderlin. Is Holderlin almost a Heidegger, so is Lovecraft to the speculative realist philosophy. That's what the blurb says about that. And there's something to that. What is it about Lovecraft that's becoming so intellectually relevant now?
Well, I'm wondering if sort of Duchamp and Lovecraft, that simultaneous like ability to create an incredibly detailed list and withdraw from any meaningful like analysis is something that is shared with this, with that moment you described the emergence or the potential emergence of a new technology, where one imagines what is about to happen. Versus the disappointment of experiencing its actual physical presence in your life.
Right.
And this that creates this tremendous tension that, again, I'm referring to Liam Gillick's lecture with some of these people there last night. And our inability, like Liam talked about the disappointment of technology arriving, especially in suburban England where you got your digital watch and it somehow didn't turn into a flying car. But there's also our inability to, he's sort of like, and he was saying that I'm using him as a rhetorical figure, but it's something I feel as well, that there's a kind of eager anticipation of the apocalypse, that we are disappointed when it arrives. And now that it has arrived, for those of you who are here in Hurricane Sandy and 9/11, when it does arrive, we're unable to recognize it. It's literally indescribable as an experience, even though we have personally lived through it. And now I'm now unable to anticipate the next time it will come.
Right.
That, like all of the art world, we painted the galleries, we live as if it has not occurred. Much, and that's sort of the Lovecraftian phenomena, is this feeling of like, you were visited, you were actually there, it actually happened, and now it is still indescribable, even though you can produce insurance bills and lading and descriptions and videotapes, all of the lists that describe it in the past, you cannot anticipate its future presence.
And I guess the difference here with past catastrophes is that the whole world lived through them. The whole world lived through 9/11. It didn't actually have to be in New York.
It's kind of different.
Oh, I'm sure it was. But
like all catastrophes, personally experienced.
There's been plenty of historic catastrophes. What was different is that they were localized. Right? You had to be. You might hear reports of them much later. But I'm sure it was very different here. The whole world experienced it in some sense that it hadn't experienced past world historic calamities.
Everyone experienced the image.
You mean like the Arab Spring that everyone experienced?
Yes. I mean, it was different to be there too for me in Cairo, but everyone did experience it in a way.
Yeah.
Twitter and so forth.
Everyone and no one actually experienced it.
William James said something interesting about catastrophes. He happened to be teaching at Stanford when the big San Francisco earthquake hit in 1906. He immediately rushed in to see, so he could see with his own eyes as a philosopher and psychologist. And he said what he found in San Francisco was a lot of physical suffering, but less mental suffering than for the people who read about it. Somehow being in it. And I don't know what it was like in New York. I was here for Sandy, I wasn't here for 9/11. And actually, Sandy was less traumatic here. It might have just been I wasn't in Staten Island, I was in Midtown, and it was just a blackout. But somehow there is something more traumatic about reading. Mentally traumatic about reading things from a distance.
Is that because it's mediated by art? And I have this one of several 40 diagrams here, trying to, while you were talking. But the one I seemed to come up with was that, you know, science and philosophy are trying to both address this central absence-presence, but art seems to be this arrow going away from it, which is something Sternfeld talks about as art as a hiding, if you like, of the diagrammatic conditions. Like it starts with a sketch. It starts with the hidden diagram, and then it takes it to a little sketch, and then it cloaks it, and it may archive it, and it may remake it. But it's not so much an absenting itself as representing itself farther away from its source. Does that make any kind of sense?
So he's grouping philosophy and science together. Putting art somewhere else.
Well, no, this is me.
Oh, this is you. I thought
he just talks about art as this, as doing that in relation to the diagram, which he views as a kind of intersecting point of these things.
Well, it's an interesting thought because early on we were talking about, like, obviously art and philosophy are attracted by each other and why they keep wanting to come close. You say philosophy, do you think in the next centuries will become more of an art than a science? But they in the end can't ever really meet or merge. It may be part of the reason why that is the diagram you just
right.
Maybe art is more discreet.
But there's a question, three questions.
Okay, I have a question coming out of the Funcke comments. I think that if I understood correctly, you were suggesting that instead of remembering Duchamp for the found object, the real legacy, the question of mutation and the distribution of information sort of in the new digital age. And so the question for Bernd Harman was how to think about information, which is always material, but is not necessarily a discrete object. In light of the Tina songs. But I don't want to take it too far away if you want to continue.
Objects means there's different meaning in different fields. Art often means much more palpably an object as opposed to a performance or as opposed to an event or something, right? Object in the sense that I use it is the broadest possible use of the term to mean anything that has a definite character, and so information will be an object for me.
But you were also against relations as the defining.
Right, but I don't think information is just relational, because information gets lost in translation, precisely because it's more than its relation. It's, you move from one place to another, it transforms, because it, any particular reception of it does not get the whole information. So I would call it an object.
For example, you speak directly to that. There was an experiment in Tokyo last year that, to some extent, inspired this whole project for me. With the direct material correlation, they did a Maxwell's Demon experiment, which showed you thoughts and energy, which have always been sort of like believed to be somehow related, right? Thoughts and energy, but no one had actually done an experiment that proved the direct one-to-one, you know, 100% in scientific terms, correlation between thought and energy. So it's a little computer that does a Maxwell's Demon thermodynamic experiment. So it sorts information, and they demonstrated the caloric cost of a sorting was cost you exactly as much information/energy to change something from an information energy state to another one. But it's a zero-sum game. There's no kind of hidden system behind the scenes where there's no mystery. Information is generated out of the material structure of the universe, and it is exactly as object-like as anything else.
But to continue with this, I feel like, information is defined by difference, right? So, to talk about information in terms of an object, like, which somehow ignores its context, it can't really exist without its context. So, I feel like every time you bring up an object or describe it, you talked about the British Trading Company, for example.
Dutch East India Company.
Right, East India Company is an object. In that Duchamp little zine, right, he talks about America's great art is its plumbing and its highway system. Are those objects? Is the highway an object?
Yes. The criterion for an object for me is simply, is it irreducible downward and upward? And if so, then it's an object.
But what happens when the plumbing system and the highway system are the same thing, which they are, and the culverts all cross through them? Now there's two objects. Or is it one object? Or is it the infrastructure? Like, the edges of these systems seem very hard to define, and I really want to understand what you're saying, but I also feel like every time I come to be like where the edge of this thing is, it's very fuzzy, right?
Okay, but the fact that we can't know exactly where the edge is doesn't mean that there's not an exact edge. And the fact is we can never know what's an object and what's a pseudo-object because we don't have direct access to the things that are always mediated. And so you have to develop methods. You have to develop methods for trying to figure out what's really an object and what's not. And this is what all the intellectual disciplines already do, I say. This is what people argue about in every field, what's real and what's imaginary. And you're never going to settle those arguments. There's always going to be blur. Was soccer moms a real demographic, or was that, full-blown campaign? You don't know. People argue about this. There are criteria for sorting out the true from the false. We're never going to have an immediate answer. As to what case of the plumbing and the highway system the same? I'm not familiar.
Well, the sewer systems running culverts, they're all built. It's just a question of how fine acts the capillary system.
Right, that'd be a case study.
But like New York, right? New York's an object. But we can't walk around New York. Some people don't consider Staten Island part of New York. Misumi has an idea of an object with a virtual center. That's very blurry, right? Is that something I should imagine when I think about these things? There's an object because there's a center to it, but we don't need to talk about the edges. And that all these things kind of slowly fade into each other.
Yeah, that's my objection to all these philosophies of the virtual. I've had this argument more explicitly with Levi Bryant, who also has a Deleuzian background, like Musumi. And I'm generally opposed to continua as a model because, the concept of the continuum, you can find a very good discussion of this already in Aristotle in the metaphysics. Aristotle says that there are certain things that are continua, and he gives examples, numbers, space, and time. And the reason they're continua is because you can't say that this lecture has been made up of two parts, or 70 parts, or 3,000 parts. It's purely arbitrary how you cut it up. It's one lecture, and how you slice it up is your decision. And the same with space. Are there 10 sections between here and the door, or 50, or a million? That's arbitrary again. There's a potential divisibility. You can't say that the space from here to the door is made up of a discrete number of parts. Number, you can't say how many numbers there are between one and two. You can divide it up however you want. There's potentially as many as you want or there might be none. But Aristotle does not say this about things. He does not say there's potentially, how many people are 116? It's potentially 116 people here, or 500, or 3,000, depending on how you cut it up. That's nonsensical for Aristotle, because these are substances. They are individual things that are discrete by nature. They're not continuum. And it seems to me that the philosophies of the virtual also want to extend it and say that the things are continuum too, and you kind of slice it up and it's blurry. And I'm against that, because I think if you get that, you're on the slippery slope to monism, where everything's a lump again. And you know, a philosopher I like Dalanda, says the universe is heterogeneous yet continuous, which sounds to me like having your cake and eating it too. The cake is here and I'm eating it. You have to bite the bullet and say, is the universe, is it a continuum? And in that case, I don't know how you get from the continuum to individual things other than as illusions of the senses. Or is the universe discrete? And if the universe is discrete, then you have my problem of how they communicate. I don't think you can have a continuum. I think you have to have, you have the continuum in the cases such as space, number, and time. I don't think you have it in the case of things. And
the sort of scientist version of this is the discrete quantization of space-time.
Yep.
And the scientist solution is that it is the same problem occurs exactly. It's like for discrete quantization to occur, it must be observed by some portion of the system itself. And when this happens, it's like, it's another ontological problem, because it's object-oriented. It's an object that's observing everything else to make everything else exist. And that can be observed at the subatomic level. It's called the Casimir effect, where you can watch the universe observe itself as it moves forwards a fraction of a second at a time to make sure it's already going to be there, which is a big problem for science, because when you're like, what the hell does that mean? The universe just looks ahead to check that it's already going to be. But that is actually what's going on, which sort of speaks directly to the...
What about your... I'm just thinking like your airplane.
Right.
If you're in the airplane, I'm sitting on the airplane seat.
Right.
It's my seat driving the airplane. But I'm also in the airplane, which is constructed of parts,
right,
which is also an object.
Right.
As you said, right? The airplane counts.
You got it. Yeah.
So is it that you can nest these objects infinitely?
Yep.
But they're not somehow part. But isn't the seat in the airplane also part of the airplane? That's the blurry way I'm talking about. It's not like me and Leah like are somehow the same thing, but I'm both myself and also a member of the university, which is also a thing.
That's right. There's no such thing as an object that is not composed of parts, and there's only in rare cases is the object not a part of something else. I call that a dormant object, when something's not a part of anything else. And it's hard to come up with examples of that, as we discovered before. But yes, you are both an individual and made of components and a part of larger systems. You're all at once. That's right.
And thank you for asking the question that I'm sure many people in the audience were thinking about. We had a couple more questions.
Taking it back to the 9/11 example that you guys were giving a while ago, how everybody experienced that, my question, I guess, is about the difference between the virtual, which I guess is an object, versus the real object. And so I'm going to take photography as an example. If you have a real physical piece of paper, or photograph versus virtual photograph. The virtual photograph on the frame, would the frame not be the object? And I guess my question is the difference between that, like the physical object photo and then the virtual object photo.
Can you tell me again what those two are?
So you've got like the physical photo, like it's a piece of paper,
printed.
Holding it, and this is my photo, versus this digital picture, which is this virtual projection onto a computer screen or a screen or a photo frame. I don't really see that as an object. I guess so my question is, where do you see that difference? Is there a difference? Are they both the same object?
I think it's three objects.
Right? Yeah, right.
Oh God, I'm getting the hang of this.
Yeah, you are. One on the screen and the printer are both translations of this code, whatever the photo in itself might be. You're never going to be able to see that, because you're always going to have to put it in some medium to see it. And so you're always going to have a translation of what the photo in itself is. Digital code, I guess, in this case, what it is, right?
Does that make sense? So there's the code, the image on the screen that the code produces, and they print it out to simplify it. But you could also have then say that those are nested inside a group of larger objects.
So the virtual and the physical photo are both translations of something that's neither of those, that is the digital code.
And I think in the case of the Duchamp, what's interesting is that there's the... What's implied in that is that Duchamp has there's an objecthood to the archive, both the conceptual objecthood, there's the actual archive, and then there's Duchamp's. Would that be a sensual object, an intentional object, his externalization of his project into this kind of weird other thing? It's like the computer code, know, there's Duchamp, and
it's
then there's
what circulates it.
And that's what makes it so kind of, in a way, advanced as a project.
You're talking about the miniaturized?
The concept that as you're making the work, it's also creating this other body of work that's yet to be made, that's all going to be tiny and weirdly handmade copies of the thing.
Yeah.
You kind of already know that, but no one else does.
That's my favorite thing he did, actually.
It's pretty weird.
Yeah.
I hope everyone's working on their own version.
I do have my books.
Little tiny ones?
Yeah. Carry them around.
Right there.
Okay, so maybe this is sort of related to your question about the digital object. I guess when I think about, I think this conversation about artists using technology and tools and like the question about what they make those things, it interests, the conversation itself interests me because what something that seems to not so often come up is the person who made the tool and their intent. I guess when I look at a computer, I see not only a tool, but a tool which contains many tools inside of it, all of which are sort of a combination of thousands of worldviews and ideologies about how I should interact with that tool through graphically inserting things or whatever, like your diagrams look the way they do because we use the software which has built into it an ideology about how systems should look or be represented. And I think that I guess this question is not fully formed, but I guess I was wondering how does that fit into your how does that fit into your philosophy, or what do you, is that something you guys think about when you talk about these things? Or because to me, like, the most interesting things that happen are when artists and designers work not just with the technology and tools, but sort of against and beyond their capabilities, like using them in the wrong way or hacking the system in a way, I think, creates the most interesting things. I just wondering if you see that as related or had any thoughts about it.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons I think Greenberg was unfair to Kandinsky. I think a lot of the innovations and thought come when someone takes a possibility that wasn't seen in the medium and does something different with it. So what if the Cubist focused on abstraction? The fact that Kandinsky isolated that and did something with it was interesting. And that happens all the time.
Kandinsky was trying to make painting into a sort of information in a very early, he was like a theosophist. But speaking, I mean, I think it's, what you're saying is true, but it's dangerous to take a historically short-term view. I'm from the UK. There's not a square inch of England that hasn't been turned into a tool by somebody. You go into the fields in like Dorset or somewhere, you pick up a flint, somebody's carved it into a flint knife and tossed it away. Then you pick up the next one, it's another knife, and they
I
go
don't
on.
Know
from
if I have like a defeatist sort of.
No, no. I'm just saying that I think that the question is like really a, does it? The larger question is like. Does this kind of technology offer anything new? Or is it really just, I think that's what you're asking too, is it just more layers and layers of all these predetermined patterns? And that's the kind of the interesting question about it. Like, is there a Cthulhu?
I say Cthulhu. He hated it when people pronounce it that way, but his pronunciation was apparently this really complicated.
Yeah. Is there the hack? Like, what's the hack? Is the hack, the unnameable? Is it the nameless one? Does he call it the nameless one?
Oh, man, there are many appellations for great food.
And in a way, is that the appeal for having these kinds of conversations? Is a way to sort of like, can we rename that strategy you're talking about? Well, I think that's the kind of rhetorical question. I think we should have one more question, and then we've been talking for about 5 hours, so we can.
At the end of your talk, you said that the most important changes happen when objects are in symbiosis. So the question then is, what's more fundamental ontologically? Is the object in symbiosis, or is it the object itself?
Both are there, but the point is, if you start only with relations, you're never going to get the object. Whereas if you start with object, you can get the relations.
Well, the question is, can you start with both?
I think my position is starting with both. The problem is when people start with the relational ontology and then try to view the object as derivative surface effects of the relations, you can't get that. So because if you relationize everything, it's going to turn into a homogeneous stew, and you're not going to have individuals.
So your objects and data is ontology.
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Yeah, because I'm not trying to eliminate relations. I'm just trying to say that you need objects in order to have relations.
Perfect. Everyone write down objects and biosis. That's your...
That's what it is.
That's thank you so much.
Next time.
Yes. Yes. Maurice liked it.